Hello everyone and welcome to this Nintendo Life. Ich bin ein Nbz and I am joined this week by my co-host, who also has to brush up on his German for our upcoming trip to Gamescom. It is Bally.
Guten Morgen, NBZ. Guten Morgen.
Even though it is the evening right now.
Yeah, I know. Ich komme aus Schottland.
Sure, I know what that means, totally.
That's I come from Scotland.
Excellent, well, good stuff.
We've got to say that a lot.
We do. Well, I'm glad that you have the German end covered, Bally, because I certainly am incompetent. I would do what one of the US presidents did and say that I'm a donut live on a German stage, most likely, because that is the extent of my knowledge.
Why are we talking about German and Germany?
Well, I quickly slipped it into the introduction there, but we are headed, Bally, to Gamescom in Germany, in Cologne, Germany, where we're going to be there for a couple of days looking at some video games, hopefully some Nintendo stuff, but also other things. There's going to be VR, there's going to be all the big AAAs, and we're going to do as much as we can. We got these press badges, which are pretty cool, which will hopefully help us get around a bit easier. We'll see.
It's quite a lot to take in, just judging from what I've seen online about Gamescom. It is huge.
Yeah, it's the biggest games thing in the world, I believe. Like,
in terms
open to
of
the public.
People going, absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, in pure numbers, it's going to be a sweaty pit in there, so we're going to have to be prepared. I don't believe I said the episode number at the start, so welcome to episode 73 of the podcast. And today, Bally, we're going to be doing something a little different because we're going to Gamescom. So how about you tell people what the show will entail?
Sure. So we're going to talk about what we've been playing as usual, and then we're going to do a big bumper second segment, which I guess we can break up into another segment later. But we're going to have coverage from Gamescom. So we're going to get out the recording equipment. We're going to hopefully get some chat going on while we're on the show floor and stuff like that. But maybe do a more slow-paced, thought-out segment in the hotel. We'll see. We'll try and put something together, and that can make up the rest of the show.
Yeah, we have no idea what that's going to be because we haven't done it yet. So we are as in the dark for what the rest of this podcast has in store as you are at this very moment, which is exciting and maybe also scary, but it will be fine. I'm excited, Bally. It's going to be
a
fun time. Yeah. So I guess let's just continue the tradition of every podcast, which is to talk about what the video games that we've been playing are. And Bally, as always, you're going to kick things off. I think you're going to kick things off with a game that I helped you to cross off your list.
I appreciate it greatly. So yeah. I finally beat Fire Emblem Fates Birthright. I started this game when it came out. It really took me way too long.
I think you got sidetracked by a few other games during the last couple of months. But yeah, you started pretty hot out the gate and then you were like, put it to the side for a bit. I think Box Boy came out, Box Boy, should I say.
Yep.
Star Fox, I think you played in there.
Star Fox, yeah. So, there's a few other games.
Yeah, a few things got in the way. But you finally cracked, like, last couple of weeks you went pretty ham on Birthright.
Yeah, and I quite like doing that at the end of Fire Emblem games. I get a real Fire Emblem bug. I've sort of done that a lot with Awakening and Fire Emblem 7 when I played it. Just push on through to the end. I did really enjoy this game overall. Like I've said before on the show, I really like the new mechanics. It feels far more strategic than Awakening.
Yeah.
I really like that, obviously, liking series such as Advance Wars. It definitely, as a result, feels a lot more like Advance Wars in Awakening. I think the story is actually slightly more engaging than Awakening as well. It's very obvious from playing Birthright that there's definitely stuff hidden. That they definitely save for Conquest and Revelations, and that's understandable. I don't mind them doing that. So the story is decent, but it could be better, and I accept that they've done that just to keep stuff hidden. For example, I'm going to get minory spoilery here.
Sure.
About that.
It doesn't. If you care about the Fire Emblem story, I'm sorry, but I quite frankly don't think it's worth much time.
I think it's quite good.
I've always thought that Fire Emblem stories are basically trash, and the only thing that makes them memorable are the characters, and I think character interactions and things like that are always great in these games, and I think the support conversations are one of my favorite parts, but when it comes down to, like, ask me what the plot of Fire Emblem 7 is, I probably wouldn't be able to tell you. It's one of my favorite games of all time, and I still can't really tell you what it's all about.
Yeah.
They're just not engaging in a way that other video game stories are for me personally.
I definitely think Awakening and Birthright, their stories seem to stand out a bit more to me in my mind. And it might be partly because they're presented in a much more impressive way with the cutscenes.
Yeah, do you think that's to do with all the CGI stuff happening?
Yeah, but I would even go as far as to say that some of the writing for the characters just feels a bit more solid. It feels a bit better.
Sure. I guess, like, it's more focused on being properly localized as to... I mean, during the GBA era, they were still localizing stuff really well, but maybe they've come on a bit since then. I don't know.
Yeah, definitely. And I think Birthright just... That's why I think it's a better story than Awakening. So I do prefer the Birthright characters.
Also, and because you're a time travel hater, so...
I'm a time travel hater, and they have their own little crazy thing.
Don't
of time
even
travel
get me
here.
Started on how the child units factor
yeah,
in.
It's horrible.
Absurd.
I don't even want to get into it. It's just horrible. Bring back time travel, I say.
Yeah.
No, but the ending is a bit strange. It's very clear that Garen is mad and evil, and you never really find out why he's so mad and evil. I was looking forward to it perhaps getting a bit more political at the end, but he's basically so mad and evil that politics is thrown out the window. Like, there's no negotiation between Hoshido and Noor. It's literally just, you know, let's defeat this guy who's just bad to the bone.
Yeah, basically.
And I'm sure that you find out other stuff about all that in other stories. But anyway, my biggest gripe with this game is the final boss. And it taught me a number of lessons. I think that both myself and the game are at fault in our own ways. So I really, really, really struggled with the final boss. And I should say that it's a final level, and then there's a break, which you can't save in, and then it goes to the final boss.
Yeah.
So I got to the final boss a number of times and failed, but the problem is you have to play the level before the final boss again. I think it is criminal of the game to not just put a save point in between those two levels. I genuinely would hardly have an issue with the final boss if it wasn't for the lack of a save point at that stage. It's just really, when you're at the end of a game, you want to get to the end of the game, you know. It's really frustrating to be stuck just before the end of a game, no matter what game it is. Almost, I'd say it's very frustrating, and I feel that a save point would be nice. Now, having said that, it's my own fault. I played this game like Conquest. I didn't do a single side mission. I maybe did like one castle invasion and one paralogue, I believe it's called.
Yes. You were calling them prologue the other day. You're confusing me mightily when you were asking about prologues. I'm like, what are you talking about, Bally?
I did one paralogue and one castle invasion. Everything else was just the standard chapters, and as a result, my units, and especially some of my most important units, such as the Avatar, were very underleveled, and they are incredibly important for that final boss. So that is my fault entirely. But I think this is just a wider problem with many JRPGs and RPGs in general, is there's often... You can often fall into the trap where your units are strong enough to get to the end of the game, but cannot beat the final boss. And
yeah.
It's maybe an unfair criticism because they're just copying the tradition of RPGs. It's not like they're doing something that's completely out of the blue compared to other games. Lots of games do this. And it's just a bit frustrating. And because in an action game, you get to the final boss, say you get beat heavily, all you think to yourself is, right, I better get more skillful and actually beat this final boss. With RPGs, sometimes it's not necessarily the lack of skill. It's just the fact that there was a lack of level up, lack of grinding. So
numbers were higher than yours, basically.
Precisely. And I had a real go at Xenoblade Chronicles when I beat that game, because I really struggled on that final boss. And it's that balance of knowing, okay, what's the part where I'm not skillful enough, and what's the part where I'm simply underleveled? And it's just a frustrating gray area to be in when you're at the end of a game. So I really struggled. Went round to your house, Nbz, and you were like, right, Bally, your avatar is way too underleveled. Like, we're just going to play this final level, and we're just going to boost up Bally's stats. So that's my avatar's name, Bally. So let's boost Bally's stats. and then you managed to do it. And we used like an extra hexing rod, and that like there were you did some other stuff, but
I did, yeah.
I needed to bring your skills and your knowledge to the fore in order to beat that level. And
I was really surprised when you told me you're at the last chapter and your main character is level 9, and I was like, no wonder you're having a horrible time, because at the end of Birthright, my Corrin was 18. At the end of Conquest, my Corrin was maxed out, was level 20.
Going...
That character is so crucial to so much of the game, and I just didn't understand how you hadn't been absorbing XP just a result of playing the game.
Yeah, definitely, and that's my fault. And
it showed, because in that level 27, chapter 27 before endgame starts, I leveled you from level 9 to level 17. That's how like easy it was for me to just take on these enemies and just push you through.
Definitely, and... I was actually quite chuffed to manage to actually get that far in the game with such underleveled characters.
Yeah, to some degree.
Quite pleased with that feat. It's, you know, it's four energy tanks with Ridley time.
Yeah.
But overall, I think this is a superb game. Like I said, the presentation is unbelievable. I know you weren't a big fan of the new units, but I really, really like the new units. I love the emphasis on Japan with those units. For example, the samurais and the ninjas especially. I think
I think the theming is cool. It's just...
Fair enough.
The classes and the way that they interact with one another, and just generally off the bat them being very weak, in my opinion, was a turn off.
The samurai and ninjas are very defensively weak, and the samurai is basically like, you know, the sword masters from previous games.
It is,
games.
Yeah.
And they actually upgrade to a sword master, I believe.
Yeah. That's the final class.
So yeah, I thought that theming was great. It's a shame you only really see Hoshido very early on in Birthright.
You mean the capital itself?
The capital itself. Or the country in general, because there are like a few places you go in Hoshido with Japanese-themed buildings.
Yeah, that's true.
So yeah, I thought it was great overall. But like I said, just that niggle of a final boss was a right pain. But I've definitely learnt my lesson for Conquest. I'm hopefully going to play it later this year. I definitely need a bit of a break from Fire Emblem, but...
Yeah, I think I wanted to play Conquest directly after Birthright, but a combination of me being very disappointed with Birthright as well as having sunk 36 hours in the space of a week into it kind of kicked me in the nuts, and I was like, yeah, I can't do this, so I don't blame you, especially when you're not as big a fan as I am.
And especially when I like to finish Fire Emblem games by playing almost at least a third of the game in rapid succession, so I'm a bit burned because I played a ton this last week, but that's Birthright.
It is.
Enjoyed it. Look forward to the next two. Nbz.
Before we stop talking about Fire Emblem, I'm just going to tack on here. I've been playing Revelation, and this was basically happened as a result of I was so high after playing Conquest. I was taking drugs all over. No, I was just so happy at the end of Conquest. I just wanted to play more Fire Emblem, so I jumped straight into Revelation, like without a second thought, and... It's not a game that I'm going to be playing regularly necessarily, although I have been playing quite a lot of it the last couple of days. I'm going to tackle it very differently from how I tackle Birthright and Conquest, in the sense that I've used all these units before, I know who they are, and I want to try something different, and so my tact here is to try and get all the child units. Now, in Conquest, I didn't get any of them, so a lot of them are going to be new to me, and I just wanted to see what I could do with grinding up skills and kind of having more of a casual playthrough and doing the sort of stuff I did at Awakening in the end game, and, you know, skill grinding and getting all the kid units and trying to do all those extra missions. The problem is these games don't really have bonus missions after you finish the main storyline, so there's not huge amount of point to like getting all those child units in Birthright and Conquest, because it's like I'm just going to finish the game and be done. Whereas here my plan is to get all the child units and as soon as I can have a full army of them and just finish the rest of the game with just child units and child units alone. I can do that from chapter 17 onwards. That's the last kind of recruitable main characters, so that's what I'm gonna do. And it's just been enjoyable, very grindy, and just like a great thing to do while I'm getting through my podcast backlog, which is kind of enormous at the moment. So it's just been a bit of therapeutic Fire Emblem. It's just one of those things. It's one of those games, Bally, that I can just kind of play and not really think too heavily about. And
Fire Emblem is not a therapeutic. No, I'm joking.
For you, no, it isn't.
We have very different places for Fire Emblem.
We do, yeah. It's like when I started playing, I sat down and like went through that chapter 27, and you're like, Jesus Christ, you're so fast, like moving everyone around and doing all that stuff. It's just this kind of instinctual thing. Having played it since I was so young, it's just kind of built into me in a way that not many other games are.
And I think like we have very different places for a game like Advance Wars as well, where I can sink a lot of time a lot faster into that, I feel.
Yeah, you can.
And you in that last level was... That was interesting.
Oh, but, boy. Yeah. But bad memories.
Bad times.
It was a hard thing. So, that's Revelation. I'll probably talk about it again in however long it takes me to finish it. But I will hopefully finish it by the end of the year. And then we can talk about all those things, all those video games of the game of the year things.
Games of the year.
Yeah. So, Bally, what else have you been playing?
We both played the game together.
We did. You're
cooperatively.
Right.
Cooperatively. So I went around to your house.
Uh-huh.
And we beat a game.
We did. It took us, 7 hours or so?
7 hours. But, you know, it was worth it. It was a good time. It was a good time. And that game was Affordable Space Adventures.
Yeah, so we've been kind of...
exclusive.
Sorry. I thought you said EU exclusive. As if Europe was the only place to get this. I was like, that's not correct. Bally, we've been kind of planning to do this co-op playthrough with one another for a while. We're like, I don't want to play this game on my own. I definitely want to do it with you and like make sure we actually get the full experience, because I think that's
definitely
the way this game was designed, is like you should have multiple people. It's asymmetric in the sense that things like Nintendo Land are, where someone is on the gamepad doing something completely different to the people on the main screen. I think people know the gist of it because it came out in the Humble Bundle. I think a lot of people have had their eye on it for a while, and it did get a good spotlight, I think, when it came out in the eShop. It is basically one person is on the gamepad controlling all these systems as if you're an engineer and like moving levers up and down and like engines and things like that. And the other player is controlling the ship itself on the screen and where it moves about. So it was a bit of a juggling act, Bally. We did switch back and forth quite a bit between who was playing on the gamepad and who wasn't. And what did you think of it overall? Like, what are your just impressions generally?
I like you were saying about asymmetrical play, I really enjoyed all that stuff with Nintendo Land. I think it's such great game design. So it feels really innovative. I mean, this is essentially a very linear puzzle cooperative experience. I think it really nails it. Some of the puzzles are definitely a lot weaker than others. There are some puzzles that are really finicky. Sometimes just really... you don't know what to do, but sometimes you might actually be doing the right thing but just not doing the right thing well enough or getting the timing wrong.
Yeah, there are certain sections where it felt like we were generally kind of doing the wrong thing, but there didn't seem to be another way to do it, and so we kind of just banged our head against the wall and were like, okay, well, I guess this is how the mechanic works, but this doesn't seem well designed in any way. And we got through it, but like those are the least satisfying puzzles where it's just like, I mean, I did it, but I don't think I was supposed to do it that way. Like, you don't feel smart about it. You just feel like, ugh, you know?
I mean, yeah, there are some puzzles where there's a massive emphasis on the skill of the pilot versus the skill of the engineer.
Sure.
And definitely a lot of the puzzles that require the skill of the engineer, there's sometimes maybe not much happening on screen apart from indicators implying, for example, heat and cold or something.
Sure.
So that's somewhere where the engineer is doing an awful lot to control heat levels, make sure the engine's not freezing or overheating and things like that. And there was a lot of that near the end of the game. And that stuff was really tough, actually, especially for the engineer. But then likewise, there are parts where the game forces the pilot to be on like a really wobbly style of engine. So like you can't have your stabilizers up at all. So they're on low as possible to stop robots getting set off. And then the pilot is left to just control this wobbly spacecraft through some lasers, for example. So I like that you never really felt left out. If you were playing engineer or pilot, the game was really saying to you, look, it's your turn to step up to the plate. It's time for you to solve a puzzle sort of thing. And I really liked that.
Yeah, in some senses, it felt almost like a strategy game where you would get to a puzzle, you would talk about it, we'd like discuss, okay, what do we have to do here? How do we approach this? Like kind of sit there for a second, discuss our game plan and say, okay, we need to do this and this, but do that quickly to make sure the timing is right. And then, okay, let's execute on it. And inevitably it would fail first time. We'd be like, okay, so what did we do wrong there? Let's figure out what the correct solution is. And eventually, you know, when you do it, if the puzzle is good and well-designed, we're like, yes, okay, this is great teamwork. Like, it really feels like you're working together to solve the problems. And that's when the game feels at its best, is when it's a challenge that's presented to you that you overcome by figuring it out with your brain and then executing it on with skill as well. And that is, it's a unique feeling. And I don't think many other games have really tried to approach co-op game design with the Wii U screen. Like Nintendo Land, a lot of those experiences were competitive based, where one person was versus the rest, whereas this is you have to work together. And it definitely is something I would have loved to see more of on Wii U, but we just, unfortunately, because of the nature of how well the system did commercially and all that stuff, people just were afraid, I think, to try new ideas. And I'm very happy that, you know, these indie studios exist, that they can go and take the chances and make games like these, which do those different kind of approaches. So.
And there are so many sort of knobs and switches on the gamepad that although that many of the controls can be done using the buttons on the gamepad, there's simply too many sort of modules that it could ever be done on anything other than a keyboard, for example, or a gamepad. Other than you could never do it on like a console controller.
No, there's doesn't have enough like inputs to be able to control all that stuff.
Exactly. So although some of the touchscreen controls are a bit finicky at times, and I mean you can control them with the D-pad very, very slowly, but ultimately it's just better to use your nail or the stylus and just touch to, say, turn the gravity up and down. I mean, there was one famous level that Raz the engineer Nbz, and it was just really turning gravity up and down, basically bobbing the craft through the level. It was really finicky, really
tough.
That's
probably my least favorite part of the game.
Exactly. And I think although the design is quite finicky, had the controller just managed to move that to buttons or just had, or been even being able to just go up and down on the D-pad, it would have been a lot more straightforward.
Parts like that generally were poorly designed in the sense that when you have these two screens, it's very difficult to maintain your view between two of them at the same time. That's why I think a lot of Wii U games forewent any sort of dual screen play, like things like Star Fox are the exception, but generally it's so much harder when the screens are detached. Like on the DS, you could certainly do it with much more viability because those screens are right next to each other. They're much smaller, so you can kind of get them both in your periphery vision. Whereas this, it's like you need to look at the screen to see where the ship is. At the same time, you need to make sure you're being accurate on the gamepad as to what you're moving up and down within these kind of fixed situations. So that generally was poor stuff that I thought, you know, wasn't the majority of the game. It was thankfully like not much of it, but certainly it could have done from trimming the fat, I think. I think the game was a good length, but maybe I think if they trimmed some of that stuff, it could have been even more tight, polished experience.
I think it's really important that for this game we get out the C word.
I think
this game is oozing with charm. Like it's I really did like the cutscenes.
See, I wouldn't use the word
setting.
Charm here. I'd say maybe a sense of quirkiness, perhaps. I think charm is reserved for something that's more, I don't know, like earthbound, maybe, which I have found myself applying that word to that game a lot. And obviously we're going to talk about that next month at some point.
But we can go with quirkiness. I really did like the setting. Like you're a spacecraft, and like it's the company. I think they're called U Explore or something.
Yeah,
they're famous for having 0% accidents. But you're like this spacecraft that's, you know, had an accident and has lost connection with U Explore, and you're constantly going through the whole game looking for like connections with Earth and the company and trying to like save yourself, and I really liked that. And the cutscenes, there's really impressive sort of branding and stuff done with all the cutscenes and all this marketing stuff that is then eerily shadowed over with like staticky screens.
Yeah, some of that fourth wall breaking, gamepad, and like moments later in the game when the gamepad like suffers damage and you can see that like the screen physically cracks. It's really cool, and I definitely think they put a lot of care and attention into the way that the story was kind of wrapping around all the puzzles and everything.
And I think it's a pretty cool ending. It's not nothing incredible or rubbish. It's just sort of, yeah, that's interesting. Okay.
I think it worked with what they were going for.
It worked really well, really well.
So, yeah, I think we're both pretty positive on this game. Like, it's really cool. It doesn't happen often that we play through a whole game together. We did it last year with Triforce Heroes, which was a very fun time. But there's something about being in person, I think, that is much more... I don't know, tangible, you know, obviously, you know, having us shout at one another and like be like,
Federation Force coming, Nbz, we can do it all again.
Well, we'll see how that goes. But for sure, I really thought that it's an experience you can't get anywhere else.
I think it was pretty special. You're right.
Yeah,
I think
it's one of those things that if you have a Wii U, I would definitely recommend this as an indie you should play, because there are lots of Wii U indies that are available in other places. There's really nowhere else that I see this game working. Like, it is so designed around this console, and I applaud them for making something that is so unique.
Definitely.
So, I always appreciate it. Even if it doesn't stick the landing sometimes, like, going somewhere bold and doing something different is what I like from games, and that's great. So yeah, Bally,
have you been playing anything else, Nbz?
I have been kind of dipping here and there. I've been looking at my Steam backlog and thinking, my god, this is a unconquerable
is a mess.
And I decided that, hey, what better place to start cutting it out than by playing games that people have gifted to me, because otherwise I feel like a shit stain of a human for like them saying, hey, I spent money on you and you're just leaving it to sit here and fester. So I'm going to be going through some games that people have gifted me and taking those off a list. And the first one is Metal Gear Rising Revengeance, which is a game that will go completely over Bally's head, because not only does he know nothing about Metal Gear, but he's never played a character action game, and none of this will make sense to him. But this was gifted to me by Roffle Mawaffle on Steam, so shout out to Roffle Mawaffle, thanks very much. I think this was gifted to me back in the winter sale, and I've been eyeing this up for a long time, because having played through MGS5 last year and absolutely adoring it, and obviously having watched Giant Bomb's Metal Gear Scanlan series, I'm very familiar with the franchise and its story and its characters. And Rising is interesting because it's set maybe a few years after the end of MGS4, which is the furthest in the timeline as far as the main series goes. And you play as Raiden, who is the main character from the second game, and he's basically a massive, like, badass cyborg, has a crazy sword, and all his skills are ridiculous. And it's basically just a character action game, like Bayonetta, like Devil May Cry, and you're going around just fucking beating the living shit out of all these cyborg enemies. And Platinum just do such a phenomenal job of creating spectacle around all their games. It's just, you press buttons and yet you feel like an absolute god. Like, it's an incredible feedback loop of visuals and audio, and what you're doing is very basic, it seems, but what you see on the screen is just like explosions and crazy things happening, and that's something that I just can appreciate from a very visceral level of like, man, this just looks good and runs well and is just fun to play. And the thing is, I'm bad at these games, Bally. I'm not very good at character action.
Good at Bayonetta.
No, I play Bayonetta on easy.
Did you ever play any God of War?
No, I haven't. That's a series I do need to get to as well. But the big thing is, character action games really feel like fighting games to me, in the way that they have combos that you have to remember and button inputs, and I'm just not good at remembering those. And as a result, I find that it's much more satisfying for me to just flip the easy switch and just button mash my way to hell. Because really what I'm here for is the spectacle and the visuals and just the nonsense that happens on screen in front. Like, I just enjoy watching it and feeling like I'm a part of it and looking like a badass, even though I'm not that good at the game, you know? So by doing that, I really get the experience I want. And I was smart to do so because there was a boss that I went up against yesterday, which was just the most like gargantuan pain in the ass. And I would have died really like many, many times if I'd been playing on normal. Playing on easy, I died once and managed to do it the second time. But I was like, oh my God, even on easy, I'm getting my ass kicked here. So I was very glad that I had preemptively made that decision. But the story is stupid. It's Metal Gear. It's just going to be a crazy thing. But one of the mechanics that I think is super cool and is just the most gore-inducing, like, bloodfest is when you're finishing off an enemy, you can hit one of the shoulder buttons and it goes into slow motion. And you use the left analog stick to just swipe your sword and cut your enemy to pieces. And the angle at which you move the analog stick, you start slicing in all these hundreds of different directions. And it keeps a counter on the screen of like how many pieces you've cut your enemy into. So you have this slow motion of you just slicing people up crazily. And it made me think of Skyward Sword in the sense that if they're... I know, weird transition.
The other game, you just slice people up.
Right, but like it made me think about, okay, there may be a way to potentially do Skyward Sword without motion controls by angling analog sticks in directions. It would obviously not be as good as the original experience, but it just popped that light in my brain. I was like, oh, okay, this is an interesting way to do this. This could potentially apply later on if Skyward Sword were to be remade on a platform that didn't have the motion plus. Yeah, that stuff is just always satisfying, and it just keeps me going. I think it's quite short. It's probably about 6 hours. I'm maybe halfway through it now. And yeah, it's just a thrill ride. You know, like often I need one of these to just chill back and just mash my way through and just enjoy the experience. And that is what I've done here. And I really want you to play Bayonetta, Bally, because I think you'll have a really fun time with it, just mashing through. I think you will. Like, it's the thing is, I don't think you know that you need it, and you really do need it. Like, the spectacle is so over the top and enjoyable to observe that it kind of trumps everything else.
I'd say this game I'm about to suggest is similar but not the same, but definitely one that appeals to me a lot more. Is Wonderful 101.
Yeah, I mean, so, it's similar. Sort of thing. Yeah.
It's not quite character action. Obviously, it's Platinum.
It is Platinum, yeah.
But that's just a really interesting game that not too many people online have like tried out, but those who have say it's like actually quite cool and all these things. And it didn't make too many waves when it came out, but I've always been intrigued by it. So I feel like I want to maybe try that first.
But yeah, that's fair enough.
If I'm like, Wonderful 101 is great, give me more action and beat him up and whatever, then I can see myself trying out Bayonetta, you're right.
I'll tell you, Bally, I was not the converted before I played Bayonetta, and now, like, I would not have played Metal Gear Rising had it not been for Bayonetta. It really converted me to this brand of action, and I'm really enjoying it now. So I think that's one thing, is like, try and push your boundaries and try some different genres, because I think you'll be surprised. So that'll be my my thing, and that's what I played. So I think that's the end of the segment, Bally. What do you think?
I think it was a good segment. I think the next segment might be more interesting though.
It might be. We'll see. Well, we don't know yet, so I'm just gonna find
hope
out.
So.
We hope so. So join us after the break where we will be chatting about Gamescom from the show. Hopefully it'll be enjoyable.
Cologne Hype Train.
Cologne Hype Train. See you after the break. All right, welcome back to the show, everyone. We are now here live in Cologne, Germany.
Recorded live.
Recorded live, yeah. We're out on the streets, as you can hear, lots of lovely people in the background moving carts and cars going by, which will, I'm sure, interfere with our recording. But it's probably a bit quieter out here than it is in the center, isn't it, Bally?
So, yeah, we should explain where we are. We're sort of in between conference halls.
Yeah.
And there's basically sort of like food stalls and things. We just had some lunch and we thought we'd give you some impressions of this morning. But I mean, Nbz in general, getting to Brussels, getting to Cologne, coming into Gamescom, getting the press passes, like, what are your first impressions?
It's fucking busy, is my first impression. No, there's a lot of people here. I was actually surprised. We went down to the indie area, first of all, and it was more sparse than I thought it would be. That does make sense to a degree, because I think a lot of the mainstream people coming here don't really know much about indie games, and they're not really interested in them. So there's lots of stuff open there that we could have a look at. But as soon as we hit the AAAs, the big crowds, the PlayStation VR booth around the corner, the Ubisoft booth just packed. We talked to a lady about trying to get into the Star Trek Bridge Crew demo for VR, and she was like, well, yeah, they're pretty much booked for the whole time. So nothing we can do about that, unfortunately. But yeah, it was tiring, I guess, this morning, waking up early. But I'm feeling okay right now. I'm feeling all right.
I definitely needed the food for a boost.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah, I completely agree that the AAA booths are far more spectacular than I think I was realizing.
They're huge. They're really enormous. And you can see where all this money goes to, really.
And it's really interesting because I've seen sort of booths like that from E3 videos and things, but actually being there and seeing them, it's really kind of crazy the amount that is spent on them. And what's really cool is that, yes, there are those big AAA experiences, but the big booths also have sort of separate smaller areas where you can play more smaller games, indie games, other games. So there is a mixture, but definitely there's just massive crowds going for the VR. That's really clear to see. We're hopefully gonna do some VR.
Yeah.
We're gonna get there.
So yeah, that's a plan for maybe later today. We'll pop by. There's definitely some indies downstairs who have VR games, and there's not that many people there, so that seems like an easy option for us to do it. We've been trying to find a Star Wars VR. Tweeted Brian Altano, hasn't got back to us, unfortunately. but we'll see about that. But Bally, we did play some things. We have played a couple of games. We started out in the indie area, as I said, and we just walked up to this kiosk for this game called Gonner, which is I would say it's this mix between Super Meat Boy and, I guess, like a side-scrolling shooter, but it's very much like a roguelike, it seems. You're kind of shooting enemies as you go through procedurally generated areas. It's got some really nice animation to it, very kind of stark colors like reds and blacks and whites. It just controls really tightly, I thought. It was very cool. I think it's coming to Steam, the guy said. He was the publisher. The developer, unfortunately, wasn't there. But that was pretty cool. I thought it controlled well. It wasn't like anything special, but I thought it was a neat way to start a cool different indie game I'd never heard of.
Yeah, it was there's a big emphasis on platforming, I feel, but it was obviously a side-scrolling shooter as well. It's really hard, I found.
Yeah, definitely coming from like the Super Meat Boy school of thought of just die and respawn.
And every time you respawned, it was like your character was slightly different, like slightly different weapon, for example, handled slightly differently.
Yeah.
The stage around you was different each time as well. I enjoyed it. It's not really something I'm used to, but it was like a really cool sort of just neat little first experience.
Yeah, totally. Lots of like cool little additions, like when you get hit, your head falls off and you have to go pick it back up again. Just a little bit of personality injected there, which was cool. So that was neat. After that, we went upstairs, and I think I played a bit of Gravity Rush 2 then. We were walking around. Basically, what we were doing is getting the lay of the land, finding where all the booths were, seeing where Microsoft, Sony, and Nintendo were, and walked across some kiosks which had a lot of games that were currently out. Like, Bally, you played like 5 seconds of Bound on PS4.
Yeah, Bound. It was
I'm trying to even remember that game, to be honest, Nbz. Like, what? What is that game?
It's
Remind
just like
me.
It's a dancer who's just like walking through that.
Oh, yeah, of course, yeah. That was strange. Visually interesting,
yeah,
but
very pretty.
Horrendous frame rate. This is a really obvious thing that I never really thought about with a conference or convention like this is. You're always standing really, really close because it's obviously a crowded room.
Yeah.
But you're always looking at an absolutely huge, like, HD TV. And it's, for a lot of games, it's really overwhelming and just quite, you need to, like, step back a few feet just to, like, take it all in. So yeah, Bound, that was okay.
So then we went around the corner, which had some other games, some of which are out, some of which aren't. Gang Beasts was there, we had a look at, but we didn't play any of it. I've seen enough of Giant Bomb playing Gang Beasts. And they had the Tomorrow Children, which is this weird, like, Minecraft-esque game, but like, no one was playing, like, it was empty booths. So I was like, clearly this is not gonna do well. And then Gravity Rush 2 was there. I played the original Gravity Rush on Vita, really liked it. And 2 just looks like a much prettier version on PS4. Some nice kind of quality of life improvements. You now have like a dodge roll to move out of the way of enemies, which I thought was neat. Helps in combat. And they've also added a new mode which allows you to do better aerial combat, because that was one of my big concerns with the first game, was you're trying to fly through the air and kick this enemy, and sometimes it'll move out of the way at the last second and you'll miss it, and a bit of that got annoying at times. But they've added this lunar mode which basically warps you towards an enemy when you're in midair, which was cool. It feels good. It uses the gyro still, which I was surprised about in the PS4 controller, looked really nice. You just watched me play a bit of it, Bally. What do you think of the visuals and the sound and everything?
Yeah, it definitely looks pretty. I can't really say much more about that, to be honest.
Gravity Rush is really based on its movement and just being able to like fall into midair and just fall somewhere else. It just feels great to do. So that was very enjoyable, and I'll probably play that when I get a PS4 at some point.
So Nbz, the highlight of the morning, definitely for me at least, and hopefully for you, I don't know, was definitely Cuphead.
Cuphead is fucking awesome. So we went over to the Xbox booth. We're gonna intend to see Sea of Thieves later today. Maybe Recore, that line was quite long. But we went to the ID Xbox area, which had like maybe 8 or 9 different indie games in that arena, and had to wait maybe 40 minutes. It wasn't too long, actually. It was one of the shorter queues. But we thought when we went in there, we'd be able to play like multiple games. Turns out they have a kind of quick turnover where you get to choose one game, say that station, and then play it for however long. And we got in there like at the end of the queue, basically. So other people had already rushed out of the stations, and we're like, oh man, are we gonna get to it? And for some reason, no one else was going to Cuphead. And we're like, okay, well fine, we're gonna play Cuphead. So, Bally, this game looks and sounds fucking awesome. And not only that, it plays incredibly well too. How were your first impressions?
So I think that the biggest thing about this game is obviously the art style. And I think it's great watching YouTube videos, watching others play it. That's a great way of picking up on art style, but it's not the same as playing it yourself to see exactly how that style of animation actually looks and works. And it just looks and works incredibly well. Like, it's so good. And you're right, the sound design is so reminiscent of that time era with like big band almost.
One thing that's interesting, a lot of the sound effects weren't necessarily that well integrated, in the sense that like an old cartoon perhaps, it's a little bit of jank around the edge, delayed and things like that, which is this weird care and attention to detail that I actually kind of expect from this game, because you look at it and you think, holy shit, how much time do they spend on the animation? Because it is really astounding. I will say, one thing that I was maybe a bit disappointed with was the kind of side-scrolling standard levels. I think they're relatively generic. We played a couple of them and they both seemed pretty similar. It's just kind of go right and kill enemies. The level design didn't seem that great. And I think that's something they added, like, when people were saying, oh, I don't want just a boss rush mode, which is what it was in the first place. But I think they probably should have stuck to their guns, honestly, because the bosses are by far the best part. They are so, so well designed.
Yeah, I completely agree. The bosses, we fought a couple. One was actually a side-scrolling style boss where you're like a side-scrolling shooter.
Yeah, space shooter.
Space shooter, that's the word I'm looking for. Both the boss fights were incredibly difficult, but great fight. It's a really hard game, but actually works really, really well. I think that we've already said, the art is just blows this game. It makes it so unique, so special, blows it out of the water. It's incredible.
It's a game that I wish was on a Nintendo platform, you know? Bally, you're probably going to be left in the cold regards to Cuphead, because I think Microsoft are publishing it. It's coming to Steam, but I am 100% picking this up when it comes out.
Are you sure there's no chance of it ever coming to NX?
Bally, I don't know. I think Microsoft published it, so that's all I'm going to say. Yeah, definitely, if you're a Nintendo fan who owns an Xbox One or has Steam, Cuphead is one to look out for sure. I mean, people have known about it for a couple of years now, but it is, yeah, by far the best thing we played, by far.
Anything else you want to wrap up from this morning?
Yeah.
The food is great.
Yeah.
Curryverse.
Yeah.
Love it.
Final thing I'll just say is I played about 10 minutes maybe of World of Final Fantasy, which is this kind of
chibi.
Yeah, it's very chibified art style. It seems like this is going to be the Final Fantasy game for people who want their old school turn-based affair, with 15 coming out, 15 being this action like spectacle. This is like a classic, you know, return to, you know, just turn-based, and there's some new systems in it. There's some enemies you can stack and do special abilities. You can call in like characters from old games, and it looks very nice. Like, it has this very clean art style that is, it has a softness to it that is very anime, but also it just pops. It's colorful, it pops. I will say the one thing, it seemed very linear, so not necessarily going to be the most like overworld centric thing where you're wandering around and finding villages, I guess. But it seemed very good from first impressions. And I guess, yeah, for people who want their RPG fix, it's another one. So
cool. So that was our first morning of Gamescom 2016. I think our food's digested, Nbz.
Yeah, I think so.
How about we go for the afternoon?
Yeah, let's do it. So, yeah, we'll be back in a second with some more chat about what we've been playing at Gamescom. See you in a bit.
All right, everyone, welcome back to the show. Much calmer right now, because we're not in the convention center. We're, in fact,
in the toilet.
Yeah, apparently, according to this thing right here. Hi, I'm Nbz, and we're in a hotel. We're back in our hotel, Bally. How are you doing?
I'm good. My feet are doing okay. I know that yours are in a bit of a bad way.
Mine are bad. Mine are just the worst thing in the world right now. But look, I'm going to have a good night's sleep, and we'll be all right. So
it's so nice to just be in a hotel room.
It is, yeah.
With the peace and quiet. Without all the crazy hordes of people that we have faced all day. And just, oh, what a hectic day. And then went out for dinner.
Yeah.
Very nice. And now it's just chilled. And we have some experiences from the day.
Yeah, you're not here
from after lunch that we want to talk about.
Exactly. You're not here to hear us yap on about freaking the hot pot we had.
Which was amazing.
It was good. We'll let you know that much. Yeah, so let's wrap up the day, Bally. So I think the first big thing we did after lunch was we went and stood in line for Microsoft's booth. The big thing we wanted to see was Sea of Thieves. So that was a pirate game that they showed off, I think, last year at E3? I can't quite remember. But it was one of the shorter queues. Also, they had like 20 or 30 stations, so they were like cycling people through on a pretty consistent basis. So I think it was a good call. And plus, it's a Rare game, and Rare are very Nintendo-centric, so I thought it would be a good one for us to talk about, especially given our podcast is Nintendo-based.
Yeah, the queue was maybe an hour and a half, and it did move fairly fast. Like you said, loads of people on the booth. And that's obviously because of the way that this game is played. So for those who don't know, you're effectively a team of five people controlling a pirate ship. And then you're facing off against another team, other multiple teams of five people. So I believe there were three ships in our game, or maybe more.
There were, like, I think the, well, okay, so they had five people on one side of ours. There were probably about four ships, or five, four. Actually.
Yeah. All I think, in the same game.
Yeah, everyone was in the same, instance. We came across two other ships during our playthrough, so it had kind of a three-way battle going on, which was pretty cool. But yeah, the interesting thing I would say is it's first person, and I was a little worried because I usually get motion sick with first person games that don't have guns in them or things that
you can see. Especially when you're on the sea.
Yeah, exactly. So it's like this combination of, hey, we're on the sea and also it's first person, wouldn't work out, but I was fine. In fact, it ran very smoothly, which I was pretty surprised at. It looked pretty clean. The water looked pretty amazing. One of those things, Bally, we used to talk about when we were younger, grading graphics on the water. Well, it looked pretty good in this game.
Yeah, really nice looking game. They've not gone for anything. With pirates, you can definitely go for something a lot darker, more eerie, and they don't at all. They go for a really sort of colourful palette, very family oriented.
It was even the art style. Even the stuff like getting drunk, like drinking your ale, you just start wobbling around like an idiot. You just literally can't move. I tried just pushing forward on the analog stick and my guy would just not go where he was supposed to. Yeah,
when we're meant to get on the boat.
Yeah, exactly. So I had to like climb the ladder on the side, which was a funny thing to do. But that game just seems like a great time with friends. I'm not sure how great it would be if you just jumped in randomly online, because there was so much communication needed to make sure everyone was on course and to make sure all the things were in place. The guy who was leading us through was an Irish guy. He was really good, and we could hear pretty well through this.
He worked for Microsoft.
Yeah, he was. Yeah, I mean, he's on their PR team or whatever. But he was basically just telling us all the stuff about it. And yeah, they had mics hooked up, which worked surprisingly well, given how loud the conference is.
Because everyone, you couldn't hear your own voice when you were speaking, so everyone who was talking was speaking really, really loud.
Yeah.
But he led us into the game really well, and that's the fundamental cool thing about the mechanics of this game, is that you really do need teamwork.
Yeah.
And you think to yourself, we're going to hit that island. I'm going to go steer the ship. And then you get to the steering wheel, and you realize that you can't see anything because there's a massive sail in your way. So you genuinely need someone in a crow's nest to look at like the horizon. But on top of that, it's really useful to have someone at the front to like tell you if you're going to hit a rock or an island or something. So there's just great mechanics in terms of teamwork. And obviously there's the cannons either side of the ship. And then people can shout out like, come to, you know, the east side or the west side and let's, you know, shoot that ship and things like this. And
there was also kind of complicated stuff with the anchor, where you could drop the anchor and do like a quick turn,
it was really funny actually, because the Irish guy leading us, Microsoft guy, he was like, we were all just on the cannons, like shooting into the abyss, and the ship had already passed, and he's just like, okay, I'm gonna go do the anchor. And he made it really clear at the start when we took up the anchor that it goes really, really fast with like multiple people. And I was watching him like for a good few seconds just doing it by himself, and it was going incredibly slowly.
Yeah.
And he was obviously just like, it'd been a long day, and he was a bit sick of everyone just ignoring when he said, let's do the anchor. But eventually I like went to help him with the anchor. He's like, oh, thanks, because it actually really speeds up the second there's just more than one person doing it.
Yeah, exactly. I think that's the key aspect, is when all hands are on deck, pun totally intended, you're going to have a much more successful time. Which is cool. It was very simple control wise as well. I think you just have like an interact button that basically worked for everything, and you just cycle through your items on the shoulder buttons. Did you figure out what you had a plank? Was that plank meant to be for boarding up the ship down below? Is that what the item was?
Yeah. So the plank, I never actually managed to use it, because every time I went down, someone had already used their plank
The Argentinian dad and son combo who were playing with us had clearly like been to the booth like earlier in the week and had played the game already, so they already knew what they were doing.
So you had a plank, which I wasn't able to use. You had your
accordion?
Your cup of ale, which I drank once and got drunk or whatever. Yeah. It was an accordion.
Yeah, I think it was an accordion.
So I kept getting it out and I tried to use it. I could never use it. I didn't even really know what it was. Did you manage to use it?
I tried to use it. I think maybe the volume on the game wasn't that high because we had to have the volume for the speakers to hear each other. So I feel like it was music being played. I think he was saying that at the very start, you can just like make a band, just have different instruments and just like play music together, which sounds fun as well, you know? I'm interested to see where they go with this in terms of, is this a full open world that has been created by Rare, or is this more procedural and you just kind of go into random ocean spots and come across people? Like, I think I'd be more interested in it if it was more crafted and you had spaces where there were like, you know, bars and pirate holes to visit and caves and things like that that had been designed by the team. I understand that obviously, like with massive multiplayer thing like this, that's maybe harder to pull off, but I don't know. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, it is an MMO, right? I mean,
kind of.
I agree, and I think perhaps those are like, they won't be there at launch, but there may be things that can be added to increase the longevity of a game like this, like just things to mix up the formula. Because we were just talking about how successful a game like Splatoon had been in maintaining an online community that kept playing. And I was just saying how concerned I was that it's a fantastic game, Sea of Thieves, but I was concerned that, you know, what if the support for it drops after, say, 2 months? And something, some added content that maybe even if they copied Splatoon and made it free, but just behind a time barrier or something? Who knows? I don't know. I'm not saying I know the answer, but something to just hold that community together. Because if the community can stay together with a game like this, I think it's a pretty special, you know, cooperative experience.
Yeah, I was surprised at how much I liked it. I wasn't expecting to get a huge amount out of it, but it has a lot of charm to it. And I think that's what people love about Rare. And I feel some people probably think that's been missing for a while. So to get that back and to have this very quirky, very fun, goofy game is real cool. So yeah, there's one to be looking out for, Bally, in the future.
Yeah, definitely. I'm not exactly going to buy an Xbox One anytime soon.
Obviously.
But it was a great experience.
Yeah.
But anyway.
Glad we did it.
Nbz.
Yeah.
What other experiences have you seen today?
Oh, boy. I did the rounds, shall we call it, of multiple different games.
I waited in queue for you.
You did, very graciously. although you were also kind of knackered.
Yeah.
We did quickly stop by the Nintendo booth for a little bit to try and play Federation Force for whatever goddamn reason, which the game's already out in North America. I think it's coming out here soon.
August the 1st, I believe, in Europe.
September the 1st.
September 1st.
We're end of August now. So maybe we'll do that tomorrow. The guy said to come back in the evening.
They only have one booth for that.
Yeah,
they
basically like four people at a time, and it was like, I think a 20-25 minute demo. It was really long.
Yeah.
So I don't know if we'll ever end up doing that.
It's not top of our list. But
look, to be honest, the Nintendo offering here is not the best.
Should we maybe explain like what's on the Nintendo? Because we've basically been around the whole Nintendo booth today.
Well, we didn't really, because we didn't go into the area with more important indies.
Yeah.
But they had a very small section off to the side, which has Mario Party, Monster Hunter. It had freaking what I just talked about, Metroid, Federation Force. They had Yo-Kai Watch there for some reason, the first one,
which is
already out. We'll get to that. But there was another area that had Smash Brothers, Pokken Tournament, Splatoon, things which are already out. So it's just like,
They were holding a lot of tournaments for all those games, I believe, and then doing like prizes. And one of the prizes apparently was, you know, you actually got to play Breath of the Wild. And talking of which, Breath of the Wild at this event, I was going to say this E3, it's not an E3, it's a Gamescom. It's it's just kind of sad and terrible. I can understand maybe why they've done it. It'd be a real effort
Bally,
to
people
have.
People would literally die if they brought Breath of the Wild to game.
Yeah, I know, but
the crowds are fucking.
I feel
insane.
Like it's very frustrating because definitely other companies have brought some pretty big guns.
Yeah.
And it is frustrating, but essentially, Breath of the Wild is a single, small booth that's completely hidden. There's just the famous artwork of Link climbing the cliff on the outside, and there's a guy with a desk next to this door that goes into the booth, and I swear to God he lets in like four people a day into that booth, and you sort of go up to him and he says, hi, we've got press passes, when we play Zelda, like we were just putting it out there. Okay, we knew we were just getting to it, yeah. And then he basically said with like a completely blunt face, "Oh, you need to get the pass to play Zelda in the business section of Gamescom." We're like, okay, right, great. And so the business area is like the one area we're not allowed to go. That's
well,
where...
I don't know if we are or not. I have no idea, to be honest.
So we just try because there's a few things in the business area we're interested in. But anyway,
we'll be allowed in.
We can try, but essentially it's mainly for what it says on the tin, business, and...
It's for the developers, really.
For the developers
for,
to
for
talk.
The, like, mainline, yeah. The big press, like the IGNs, the GameSpots, and people like that, so... yeah, anyway, got a bit off track there, but what we were just talking about, the Nintendo booth. Yeah, so tomorrow we're planning to see the other indies at the booth, which includes, like, the Wii U version of Axiom Verge... and Severed, I think, is going to be mm-hmm. there, as well as the appointment we have, which is World to the West, I think. So that is from the Tesla grad developers, Rain Games. So that'll be a fun thing. And we'll see, hopefully, all those games at once, because we're going to get directly in there, so we might as well hang around and try and do all of them. But... the things that we did play from the Nintendo booth, let's quickly go over. I played Ace Attorney 6 for literally about 2 minutes because I realized this is a bad game to demo at a show. Like, it's all text reading and having to listen to story, and I couldn't really hear in the headphones. It looks nice from, like, the tiny amount I saw, but that game's coming out, like, next month, and I'm going to play it then anyway, so I thought it was a bit of a waste of time for me to sit there and do that. Did you play anything while I was doing that Ace Attorney thing, or were you just standing there? I can't remember.
I think I was attempting to wait for Federation Force, or was I playing my other game? Or was that while you were playing Dragon Quest?
It's all blurring in my brain. But we did, I think when we were trying to wait for Federation Force, we had a go at the new 3DS game from, is it 10 AM Games, who are the Rumbo guys?
Yeah.
So they had a game called Pirate Pop Plus on the 3DS.
Weird and bad.
Really, you did not like it?
Why? They shrink down the screen so it looks like a classic Game Boy screen almost.
Yeah.
And you're actually playing off this tiny, tiny screen, and I just don't understand why you would shrink a game down so much.
I guess it
felt really small and nothing special. It was like a very classic game we used to play called
Pop. I guess it's like
you pop bubbles. It's not. I don't know. It wasn't great for me.
I can't remember what the actual original game is called, but it's like. You have a character on the ground and they put up like a rope and it like spears the middle of two bubbles and creates two smaller bubbles, and then you have to spear those and basically eliminate them all. They had a different mechanic where you could turn the screen and like be on the side or on the top of it and like be upside down and stuff. But yeah, I mean, it's very simple. I'd imagine it's a very cheap eShop game. It doesn't seem like it has much more going on apart from probably a few modes and things, but... it was interesting to see it. You know, it's one of the newer things here, so good that we at least gave it a bash. So then we decided it would be a good idea to go stand in line for VR, and Bally decided to just sit there because he was feeling like he just wanted to sit there. I don't know. Feet were tired, but I soldiered on because I'm a man, and I went and saw four different games. All indie games at the Indie Arena, and I will just quickly go through them. The first one I saw was called Black the Fall. It was, I guess, very kind of noir visual style. It was very black and dark, and it had kind of like robots. It felt kind of similar to Inside in aesthetic, although definitely not as artistic as that. It was very much more polygonal. It was rough, I felt. I think it was very early stages. Using the controller, when I had to shine this spotlight, it was almost like I was using a mouse cursor to move it about. And that really indicates, like, this guy is clearly still developing this and it's not optimized properly for a controller. So it's like, you know, moving a mouse around with a... So it's a bit weird. I got to a point where I just got stuck and I didn't know what to do. So I just left that and I was like, all right, well, maybe next time. So that wasn't great. But then we go into my secret hit of the show, Bally. Which was an indie game that I just went up to, and it's called Fossil Echo. And I think on one of the quotes on their booth, because I had quite a few awards on there, one of the quotes from Kotaku was like, it's a 2D Eco. And Eco, obviously, the first game from, what the hell are they called? The Last Guardian developers, the studio Japan. And they basically made a 2D Eco, which is a puzzle platformer. More of a action platformer, I guess. Like, there's some puzzle elements to it. Like, so there was this one segment where there were guards patrolling on a pass, and you had to basically wall jump up an area. And I got up there, and one of the guards turns around and shoots in your direction, and he's going to kill you if you're not paying attention. So what you have to do is you have to go up there, get him to turn around, and just before he shoots, jump off the edge, and his bullet will go past you and hit the other guard on the other side. So using their own weapons against them, which I thought was really neat. And some more puzzles kind of revolved around that stuff, but I really enjoyed it. I thought it was just so clean and a beautiful art style. Had some great jumping puzzles to it. I always love that stuff. And it had a good soundtrack too. I could hear the music pretty well. So that's, you should check that one out. I think it's probably coming out soon on Steam. Fossil Echo. Don't sleep on it. Very, very cool. Next one was is called ICEY, all capital, ICEY. Super, like, frantic action game. Felt kind of like a 2D Bayonetta almost. Lots of really ridiculous moves. It was gorgeous to look at, really well animated. That's something that really impresses me. Like, if I'm walking by something and I see a lot of frames of animation and it running extremely smoothly, that's going to catch my eye. And this did. It certainly had a bit of jank to it, a little bit of problems, but it was very kind of neon futuristic, had this woman who was very kind of like robotic. And it, as I said, like 2D kind of action game. So just brawling, smashing things. Good fun time. And then the last one is called Slime Sam, which was, I would compare it to, so you know that game I played last year called Ink, which was like this 2D puzzle platformer where you sprayed ink on walls that were invisible and you found them. So the walls here are visible, but as a slime, you kind of paste them with your goo as you go along them. And it is basically a Super Meat Boy style game where you're going through very short levels, ramping up in difficulty. You have like a dash, and you have an ability that lets you phase through certain colors. So you can phase through green. Your slime is cut the color green. You can phase through green, but you'll die if you hit red, basically. So it's very simple color coding stuff. And it's just my kind of game, you know. It's just very quick respawn after death. And just felt good to play. The developer, I caused a bit of a bug in the game, and he had to wander over and be like, oh no, I'm very sorry about that bug. I'm like, no problem. Like, you made this video game. That's more than I could do. So
I just play it.
I'd say my standout from that was Fossil Echo. But all four were really interesting, and I think it's great to just run around and see games you've never heard of, because it starts exposing you to things that maybe you'll want to play later on. And that happened, so I was pretty pleased with that. So, Bally, before we go into the big thing, which was the VR thing, let's just wrap up the two Nintendo things we did at the end of the day, which was I played a bit of Dragon Quest VII. It was all in German. I couldn't change the language.
Really?
Yeah, I went up to it. It was all in German, so I just fucking buttoned my way through. Obviously, RPGs demo not very well.
This sounds silly. There's a lot more German at this show than I thought there might be. I thought there'd be a lot more English about, and obviously there is. But just a real huge amount of Germans and Austrians, as we've discovered from Street Pass.
Lots of street passing. So, but yeah, I mean, Dragon Quest, I have not much to say about it, really. It looks very nice on 3D screen. Seems like pretty cleaned up. It looks more cel-shaded than I thought it would, which is good. I think that works on 3DS pretty well. Cel-shaded art style is very nice to look at. And yeah, I mean, battles were standard fare. It's a remake. It looks nice, so I'll probably play it, I guess. Then Bally, we don't have Rhythm Heaven in the UK or in Europe yet. It's not been released. Already out in America, but it's coming out in October here, I believe. And while I was doing Dragon Quest VII, you hopped on a bit of Rhythm Heaven.
Yeah, so played a bit of Rhythm Heaven. Never really experienced anything like, I've just started Rhythm Thief, I should say, on the 3DS, and that's the first time I've ever played any sort of rhythm game.
That isn't called Guitar Hero.
That isn't called Guitar Hero. That isn't WarioWare, if you can even compare that. It's very similar in some ways.
The reason people would compare it to WarioWare is I think it's the same team who do both series. They're both similar in the sense that they're really wacky in Japanese and have very bite-sized, small things that you're doing. So
I mean, I'll talk about Rhythm Thief next time on the show when I hopefully will have finished it by then. But Rhythm Heaven just, it's just so much more fun than Rhythm Thief in the sense that,
and you only played it for like 5 minutes as well.
No, exactly, and like that's because it does what it says on the tin. It's rhythm games. It's Rhythm Heaven. It really is, and it's what's great about it is that they are, you have to be so much more precise, I want to say, with a game like Rhythm Heaven than other rhythm games. It's really, really precise. And they sort of tutorialize all each game you come to. So, for example, I start with like this table tennis one where you have to just return the ball in time. And every single game I played today was just the use of the A button. And I don't know if the whole game will be like that or whether there'll be other buttons used or touchscreen, hopefully not. But only the A button for these demos. And the tutorial teaches you that this is the timing, and it's got like a visual beat sort of going along the touchscreen. And then you just press A at the right time. It tells you when you're pressing A, and then it'll tell you if you're pressing it like too early or too late with like a visual indicator, which is quite cool. And then when they take you into the main game, they completely take away the visual helper, and it's just you and timing, and you're literally looking at the mini game itself and listening to the beat.
Did you watch the quick look of this on Giant Bomb?
I don't think so.
You should go back and look at that, if only because the thing that you're saying about having to be on rhythm, Jeff kind of tests that out where he closes his eyes and relies only on the music to do it. And he does a pretty good job.
I completely agree. And I tried to do that at times. I would try to like actually look at you and like look away and just try and do it with the headphones. And it worked to some degree, but it's almost like you do best when your eyes are matching your ears and you're trying to coordinate the two, because there is still visual aids in the mini game itself. So I was doing another one where you have to chop wood, and you have to chop the block of wood just as the angle of the wood is right. And you can't tell the angle of that wood just by audio. You can only see it, but obviously there is an audio cue as well. So by linking the two, you're sort of getting your brain to work in this really unique way. It feels really interesting, but it just worked really well. It was a type of game I've never really tried, and it was just solid rhythm minigames, and I really do want to pick up this game in, did you say October?
Yeah, that's what it's called.
Looking forward to it. I am quite excited about it now.
Great. That's good to hear. I'm interested in that as well. So I'm sure we'll be talking about it on the show later on. But Bally, we've come to the end.
Oh boy.
So we were debating all day about what the hell are we going to do about VR, because there's
all the lines are crazy.
There are so many options right now. Obviously, Sony have PlayStation. There was an Oculus booth. There was this weird stuff like in the family area upstairs that had some VR going on. But it all seemed like we could just jump into whatever we wanted. We'd have to choose, like based on time, of course, like the Sony one we went to and inquired, and one of the guys who was in line was telling us that he'd been standing there for 6 hours, and we were like, Jesus Christ.
And he's like, when I got into this queue, I was completely sober, and I've been in the queue for 6 hours, had a few beers, and I'm really drunk. And we were just like joking, well, by the time he gets to the bloody front of the queue, he's going to be too drunk to even try the VR.
Exactly. So what's the point? He's not going to enjoy the experience of the VR. Which was unfortunate, I guess. But I think we're probably going to try and maybe do some VR stuff tomorrow morning, because with our press pass, we can get in an hour before the public descends on the center. And
we're just getting everyone's hopes up, Nbz. Like, this could be a massive fail.
It could be, yeah. Who knows? But, well, obviously, you'll hear that in the next section when we talk about it tomorrow. But let's get on to the VR itself. So we decided eventually to go for this demo, which, I don't know, it looked like the queue was short enough, so we just decided to. It wasn't necessarily the demo was really piquing our interest.
This is in the indie area, so it's like smaller demos, smaller VR experiences.
So many fewer people there, so it was much easier to get stuff. And this was called Holo Cafe. And so when we got to it, the guy starts talking, and he's describing a MOBA, and Bally and I look at each other and we're like, uh-oh, what have we done? Why are we? I don't want to play a MOBA in VR. That sounds goddamn awful. But really, I mean, I guess it's MOBA-like, but it's kind of the core of it is basically it was a tower defense game where
against each other.
Yeah, basically, that was the important part. It was two players versus one another, and Bally and I played it at the same time.
Because I had been standing there waiting while Nbz did a few other indie games, and the entire time I didn't even realize that the two people playing were playing against each other. I just assumed they were doing their own thing. So when we finally got to the front of the queue, it's like, all right, you play against each other. So, oh, cool, okay, right. And I think we were just, all right, time to get competitive. And I don't know, we weren't that competitive because this was our first VR experience. Like, we were, I was really, really excited. Yeah. Like, I had no idea what to expect. And just being talked through all the things. And like, I've heard so many podcasters talk about, you know, their first experiences with VR and what happens. And it's that magical feeling when you do put on the goggles. And then you're like, right, how am I going to find the two remotes? How's this going to work? And then the guy hands it to you.
Yeah.
But then in the game, they're just floating in the air.
It is the most fucking natural thing in the world. I think that's the one thing I'll say about VR is I don't necessarily think it like blew my socks off in ways of like, oh, this is incredible future technology. It was more like, this feels so natural.
Mm.
This just feels like I'm living in this different place. Like, I'm just completely out of touch with the reality that I'm in right now. And I'm just,
it feels so real.
Yeah, you feel, like, so free and available and able to move around. And you just forget that you're attached to this headset and there's wires and people around you. As we found out when Bally hit me. Ah. Like, trying to throw a fireball in my face. but, yeah, so, like, you turn around and literally I reach out my hand to grab this controller from the guy. And he's like, oh, wait a second, I'm going to put a wrist strap on. But, like, the depth of which my hand reached out was, like, perfect. Like, I touched it. I couldn't even see my hand on the VR device itself. Like, that was a ghost thing that kind of like happened. And I just grabbed it out of natural necessity. It's really weird how perfect it is. It's just so on point.
How about we explain the game?
Very quickly.
And what we're doing. It's very simple, so there are a series of platforms between me and Nbz. Half of them are blue, half of them are red. I'm blue, he's red. Aim of the game for me is to turn all the platforms blue. The aim of the game for him is to turn all the platforms red. And there are basically warp points that we can warp to. And from these points, you can shoot a variety of three different weapons. And you shoot the weapons at the platforms to change them into your color. So it's tower defense in the sense that like stuff.
It's more capturing you. Towers.
Yeah, it's capture the towers, and the three weapons are a bow and arrow, these fireballs which you sort of throw, and these weird lasers that you have to charge and then sort of zap out.
Yeah, they kind of like go to a distance, I guess. They're like minions running around as well, which are like things that you kill in MOBAs, I guess. I don't know. I don't know what they were really doing. I guess they were trying to convert towers for you. We got to a point where all the minions were dead because we just killed them. Each other had gotten rid of them. And we were just kind of going around trying to take them ourselves. But I didn't realize you could warp until quite late in the game. And so I was kind of sitting in my place, like trying to do stuff and not actually being that effective.
The guy who... So we each had like one guy with us to like help us put on the system and teach us what to do, and the guy I had was far more vocal. He really explained each of the weapons in depth, and he said like, oh, this, and during the game he'd say like, oh, you're not doing so well with that weapon, why don't you try this weapon? And then he sort of showed me onto the fireballs from the bow and arrow, and then I started dominating with the fireballs. Yeah, and did really well. Chucking. And then he was saying like, oh no, I found your weapon. He was like really nice guys. I believe they were German. And just really nice guys, really helped to explain the experience and everything. And like the developers of the game were at the side at the end, and like we went over and like thanked them, and just like, that's such a great experience. We were on a huge high, obviously,
from
VR. But it's just such a neat game, and it's a really good example because the three weapons are so different to use. You used a lot more of the bow and arrow.
So I think the other thing that impressed me was, and it's funny because we had the question about vibration last week, or the last episode, and how necessary that is for immersion. And guess what? When you're fucking inside a VR helmet, it helps a hell of a lot because pulling back with those move controllers... we're playing on the Vive, we should say.
HTC Vive.
So we're using those... I don't know what they're called, actually, because Oculus has the touch controllers. I don't know what the Vive versions are.
They're essentially the same, but just the HTC Vive version.
Basically. So pulling back the arrow string with the bow...
Like triggers.
Yeah, you have the triggers, but also you get this audio feedback and this vibration, as I was saying. So it feels like you're knocking the arrow into your bowstring. And like you almost feel the tension of pulling it back as well, which is kind of crazy.
It's almost like the subconscious of your brain simulating it. Exactly. Yeah. It's like a phantom restraint
like
or
if
something.
You thought the Wii fucking archery in Sports Resort was pretty good at that stuff, like this is another level of that. It's just taking it into a completely different direction. And like the really impressive thing, and I was just doing this out the start, was I was just pulling the arrow back really far, like knocking it and then shooting it really high into the distance, like, you know, on medieval things and like Game of Thrones and stuff, where the archers just aim super high and the arrow just like soar through the air and like duck down. And I was like aiming for one of your further crystals away, and I was like hitting it every time. I was like, and it would just like soar through the air. But like, because you have the 3D display, which obviously very much 3DS technology there, glasses-free 3D, which allows you the depth perception, just watching it go to the distance is... It's so silly. It's just like a fucking... just an arrow flying through the air.
It's so satisfying.
It's so satisfying. Yeah. You feel like a real goddamn Legolas with that bow and arrow.
Yeah, you were definitely doing some sort of slow-mo Legolas, look at me. And then I just be next to you, like, fireballing away, just waving my arms frantically. And that's the really funny thing, is we could actually see each other.
Yes.
So we weren't able to ever stand on the same platform because it had to be your own color to stand on it.
Right, yeah.
But there were times where we were only, like, one platform away from each other. And I can just see Nbz, like, lining up his long burnout. Arrow shots, and I'm just standing there like going ham with the
I see is just these shaking controllers and fire just raining down from the sky. I'm like, oh dear, that was a bad thing. But man, Bally, that was I was worried that my first VR experience would be a mess and horrible because obviously we have issues with my motion sickness. Mm. But
and we went off after lunch.
Well, yeah, I mean, it was quite a while after, to be fair. But I had zero problems. And I think that has a lot to do with us using the motion controllers as opposed to just having a PlayStation 4 controller in our hand with an analog stick. And I think the teleport mechanic helps with that a lot because it allows you to move around spaces without having to worry about it. Like, it's a good way of getting around things which will cause nausea. But yeah, having the space to move and being able to freely, you know, waggle your arms and just go crazy was... I felt so natural, as I said, and at home with it that I wasn't even thinking about anything that would make me maybe feel out of place. It just didn't. It just felt so good. And obviously that has to do with keeping a very high frame rate, which you need for
Field
VR.
Field of view.
Yeah, the FOV was pretty good. I will say the first time I put the goggles on, I did feel a little bit narrow in terms of like, I told you about this, but I think maybe because your helmet got tightened a bit more. Mm. Initially, like, it feels like almost circles that you're viewing through, like goggles on the outside of your eyes.
And when, and you're essentially looking at two circles that you're lining up your eyes to when you're putting it on, and that's almost off-putting because you're going from looking through goggles to then just having one view. And obviously your two eyes, like the 3DS 3D, your two eyes are looking at two different planes.
Yes.
And that's what's creating a 3D image. But when you're actually putting it and you're seeing the circular goggles for each eye, you're right, it is a bit off-putting, but...
I think you get used to it, definitely. But that's the one thing, I've never heard anyone talk about that. It's one, like, there's lots of things about VR that people say, but there's just like these things when you start out, it's like, I didn't expect that. I don't know. I didn't know what to expect. Like, how big would the screen be when you put it on? And it turns out like it's not actually that big. It just creates this sense of immersion through, you know, kind of tricking your brain almost. So.
But would you say that you're a VR convert?
God, I don't know, Bally. The problem is every VR experience right now is so skin deep. They're the sort of thing where that was fucking really fun and I would play
our
that.
Arms were tired though, weren't they?
Literally.
You can't do that forever.
Yeah, the bow and arrow, it took it out of me. And obviously, like, people playing this for the first time would absolutely love it, but am I going to continue to play this MOBA thing again and again for a while? Is it going to get boring? I don't know. It's just, there's not much depth to it, despite the fact that it was, you know, a fully functioning game. And that was a big deal, really, I think, because we didn't... Experiences in VR and, like, just looking at things or riding a roller coaster, I get it, but I would rather be doing something active and playing something. And I think this kind of was the best of everything for us. Like, it was a real game, it was a thing we could do together, and it gave us a great sense for using those controllers and everything, really. So, good pick, I'd say.
Yeah, definitely had a bit of everything. I am definitely a VR convert. I can see myself definitely picking up a VR headset in the future. I'm not going to say near future because I can't see them coming down in price to an area where I'd be comfortable picking it up on top of, you know, an NX or a Nintendo console or something. Yeah. So I think that there's a way to go for me to pick one up. But and I agree with many gaming journalists we listen to, where that we're still waiting for that killer app, you know, that adventure game, that lengthy VR experience that you can play VR for, maybe like an 18-hour game, let's say. It just needs that killer app.
Long
that,
time in
maybe that is too long. Maybe you can shorten that to 12 hours. Yeah. I don't know. But you're right. At the moment, it's just experiences, and there are still loads of experiences that we're very keen to try. And maybe our views on where VR goes in the future and how we feel about it might change after more of those experiences. But great start, and I need more VR.
Yeah, we'll see if we get some tomorrow. We'll find out.
I hope so.
But yeah, it's going to be us for the evening. wrap up. We'll be back again with more after this break, I guess. So don't go anywhere.
We'll need new feet.
Yep. New feet coming in the morning. So we'll see you after the break. All right, everyone, welcome back for our final segment of Gamescom 2016 coverage about the last day. We are now actually back in Brussels. We were extremely exhausted from the travel and from just staying up for how many hours.
Confusing train stations.
Yeah, man, we almost... God, let me tell you, don't get a train from Cologne to Brussels. It's a bad idea. But we're back here and we are ready to talk about the last few things we saw on the second day. And we're going to kick things off with the early morning when we woke up to get into Gamescom before the majority of people, thanks to our press passes, which was very helpful. And we went straight to some VR. And we had to decide beforehand what we were going to do. And we thought that the best thing was go to the Batman booth where they had the Arkham experience.
We also had a really interesting experience just waiting in the line for Batman Arkham VR or whatever it was called. Because... this guy just randomly came up and spoke to us, and I was like, oh, I wonder who this guy is, and he was just getting to talk to us about VR and things, and then I look at his badge, and it turns out he's like one of the producers on Dynasty Warriors.
Yeah, that was really weird. It's the kind of thing where you're just walking around and there are all these people who clearly like work on games and are like high up. And he was just like chatting with us like a normal person, like excited about games and excited about what's coming out in the industry. And we just looked down, oh my god, this guy's like from the Beijing offices at like this company and like producing on Dynasty Warriors is ridiculous. So that was cool. But we got into the Batman VR demo. And obviously this is a Sony exclusive, so it was using the PlayStation VR headset, which was the first time we got to try that thing out. Man, we both had quite interesting times with this demo. I think, Bala, you started it off.
Yeah, we were in the booth at the same time, which was quite cool. So, and they were really relaxed about us taking pictures and things. So it was nice being able to see each other's reaction. Yeah. So I went first. Nbz, I believe you looked away from my screen, yeah, not to spoil, and you could, but you were looking at what I was doing. So first impressions of sticking on the headset. It definitely feels more comfortable around the back compared to the Vive, the PlayStation VR I'm talking about. It's a really the band really works well, quite easy to tighten. I had some issues with the front of the headset. It was quite difficult to seal it below my eyes. Maybe that's just to do with the shape of my head, or maybe I wasn't tightening it in the right way. I would be concerned if it doesn't get any tighter, because I could definitely feel a draft and sometimes a bit of white light coming in from below. But yeah, so you stick on the headset, and then we should also mention the headphones. They've got pointy bat ears coming out of the headphones.
Not that that benefits you personally, but obviously when you're looking
makes
at someone,
you look like an idiot.
Yeah, it makes you look like, oh my god, I'm literally the Batman right now, which is pretty cool.
Yeah, really, really cool. So you put on the headset and you're standing in front of this piano, and Alfred walks over to you. And he's really quiet at first, and I'm thinking, oh god, they've put the headset, the volume's too low, this is going to be a horrible experience. But he actually gets louder as he gets close to you. Very thematic, but works really well. And then he says something along the lines of, Master Wayne, here's your key. He gives you a key. He also points out a photo of your parents on top of the piano that you can pick up and look at. And I sort of picked it up and I was like twisting it around in my hand, and it was really, I was like, this is great. I'm just loving VR. So that was just a really simple thing. And then you twist the key in the piano, open up the piano lid, and what do you do when you open up a piano? You play some piano keys. So you start playing some keys, and then the floor opens and you go down and down into the Batcave.
Like the shaft, and you're just like on an elevator. And I, funnily enough, did get some sense of locomotion, even though like you're standing completely still and nothing's happening. Like being in that environment made you feel like, okay, I'm actually kind of moving down here and things are happening. That was cool. I think my first impression when I put the headset on was, okay, I immediately see that this is less powerful than the Vive, because the screen is much blurrier, the resolution is clearly lower, and I'm not sure if it was necessarily what the headset was calibrated for. Maybe there were some issues with what we had. I don't know. It just looked very blurry to me, more so than I expected.
And it might be one of those cases where the headset that's on the show floor the whole time goes through a lot of beatings and things, and there might have been something wrong with it. Who knows? I mean, we certainly thought some of the 3DSs in the Nintendo area were really disgusting and really grubby. So if that was your first experience of a 3DS, it was a really negative one, to be fair. I thought it was a bit blurry. Frame rate was good.
Yeah, obviously.
It worked really well. This idea of going down the lift shaft just works so well for Batman. And this is a big issue with VR, is that lots of the experiences that aren't in vehicles, you're standing on the spot. Lift shafts are just a great way of being able to stand on the spot but still move through an environment and experience different locations.
Right, and I think a lot of people are getting around the movement thing via teleportation, like just pointing to a place and zapping there, which is what the Vive demo we played did. And I think this Batman one probably does something similar. We didn't get to play the full thing because I know the press, like at E3, Greg Miller talked about it and how there was this whole crime scene investigation. Obviously, that's a much longer thing and they can't do that here because they would never get through everyone. There are so many people. And we were very lucky to be like first in line. Literally the first.
So we were literally the two first people in line for the entire day on Saturday of Gamescom, which was just incredible. And the second we'd even finished, there was a queue right back to the back of the holding area they had. So the queue was already 3, 4, 5 hours long by the time we'd finished. And we were like, God's sake, this is just, it's so brutal. So yeah, the extra hour in the morning made such a difference.
I think the thing that struck me the most about Batman is, even after like seeing it a bit blurry and everything, you start to get immersed despite that. And it's much more about, for me anyway, it was kind of playing with the tools at my disposal and messing around and seeing what worked. I'd heard Jeff Gerstmann talk about this demo on the Giant Bomb E3 live streams, and he said, like, there's this photo frame and Alfred comes along, and so what he did was just throw the photo frame at Alfred's head. So I was like, oh, I remember Jeff talking about that. I'm going to try this. So I pick it up and I just start chucking this photo frame about. And it's funny because it just keeps respawning even though you throw it away. So it's like this endless supply of this photo frame that you're just chucking at him, and he doesn't react or anything. It hits him square in the face, and it's pretty cool. I also tried to like throw it in one hand and catch it in the other, and that didn't quite work out. I think it might be possible.
Really?
Yeah, it definitely felt like the physics could have worked there, but yeah, generally, like, that was my first impression, was like, I'm just gonna mess about and see what I can do.
So you get like other sort of grapple point and click weapons, and you get the batarangs, and you just get this sense, and you have an unlimited supply of batarangs on your belt that you can just pick up, and you can see, you can rotate your hand and see yourself holding it, and then you just chuck it, and like there are some points that you aim at and hit, but you're not really aiming. You can throw them anywhere you want and they'll always hit, so there's no sort of
automatic targeting going on.
Exactly, it's auto targeting. It's not exactly Wii Sports disc, frisbee disc, whatever. It's quite different. But Nbz was telling me that when I was doing the demo, I was sort of, my hands were by the side, my side, and Nbz was sort of thinking, oh, he's really not enjoying this. He's not really into it. But the funny thing is, I really was. I was getting so much out of it just from standing still and looking around. And obviously, I'd throw the batarangs when you were meant to, and the grappling hook and things. But then, so Nbz went second, like we were saying. And the guy helping us with this demo, when Nbz was doing it, like the second that Nbz got the batarangs, he just like grinned. And then he starts just throwing the batarangs everywhere and just like throwing them into the sky and looking up. And then the guy says to me, like, your friend's having a really good time with this demo. And I was like, yeah, he is. So like, we just had really different ways of treating the demo.
Yeah, so I think Bally was like, I'm immersed in this Batman world and I'm going to look at every detail. And I was like,
I'm going to be Batman.
Yeah, basically. And I was like, oh shit, I can throw these batarangs everywhere? So like, while we were going down the elevator shaft, I just took the batarangs and just started throwing them up to the ceiling to see if I could like get them lodged up there and stuff. So I did that like 3 times. And then while you're going down the shaft, all these bats start flying by, like through the cave systems. I'm like, man, can I hit one of these bats? I kept trying to hit the bats, and like, kept, because it's endless respawn, like I could just do it as much as I wanted. After a little while, I grabbed both the scanner and the like grapple hook thing. I started like as if I was with two Uzzies, like going boom 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 boom. I was basically just goofing around the whole time, and that was the thing that sold me on it most of all, was like just doing the stupidest stuff, because it feels so natural to do, and you feel like it. You have power inside of a game that usually you're just divorced from. You're like, okay, this character is doing this awesome thing. This time it's like, I'm doing this awesome thing, and it's like super cool.
And we should mention that I believe it's called the PlayStation Move.
Yeah, they're using the Move controllers.
So they're using Move controllers. So it's if you don't know what a Move controller is, it's basically
a Wii remote with a trigger. Yeah.
And a button on top. But we were only using triggers, and that was what you used to grip things. Yeah. But
basically, disembodied hands were what you were using. So.
Yeah, and when the demo ends, you just. I saw like a Joker card on the desk, and I tried to pick it up, and just as I pick it up, he's just like, oh, your demo's ending. I'm like, oh. And it's just like the most deflating feeling, taking off a VR headset, and you're like, oh. But, I mean, we were just on such a high. It was overall just such a great demo. And we really had to like decide. We had one slot at 9 a.m. in the morning where we thought, there's one thing we're guaranteed to be able to do. What shall we do? And I mean, Oculus and PlayStation VR, their booths had numerous demos and things inside them, and we didn't really even know what they were demoing within those. Yeah. And we were worried that you might not get the one you want, or you might be put on something you didn't want to do or whatever. So we thought, let's just go for Batman. We know what we're getting. We like Batman. We hear it. It's a pretty cool demo.
And I'd heard people talk about it at E3, like people that I know and journalists that I follow were saying positive things about it. So I was like, yeah, this is going to be a good experience. So we might as well go for that. Plus, it gave us the chance to try out the PlayStation headset, which was a different one. So now we have experience of both, which was good for comparison's sake. And let me know, like, man, I really wish this Batman thing wasn't a Sony exclusive so that I could see what it looked like in the Vive, because I think it would like shine really, really nicely. So after that, we moved on to another thing, which we thought we could probably make in another decent line before we were, you know, consumed by the masses of Gamescom.
It was a decent line compared to what it was later in the day.
Yeah, it was. So we went off to Recore, to Microsoft's booth, for the third time. It's funny because lots of stuff we did was focused around Microsoft. I think Nintendo
have great games coming out this year. Simple as that, right?
But also, it's those specific games that we looked at were very geared towards the Nintendo fan. And I think with Nintendo's kind of lack of presence at Gamescom and having experiences that were like, I mean, you know, Federation Force is already out. Who the hell wants to play Mario Party? Monster Hunter is already out. Like, a lot of these games were there and we got some cool experiences from them, but they weren't necessarily the things that we wanted to cover.
I mean, we should reiterate how hard we tried to get into the Breath of the Wild.
Yes, so, oh my god.
I think we were a long way off it still, but, you know, we put the show on the line. We said, look, we're a Nintendo podcast. Yeah. We really wanted like our listeners to hear about what we thought of Breath of the Wild. And we were speaking to the right person. We were speaking to someone fairly senior who had definitely been dealing with different businesses and journalists in the Breath of the Wild demo. And he said, unfortunately, I can't let you see it. And we were like, oh, that's okay. And then
he was very apologetic.
And then I joked, it doesn't matter anyway, the game's out soon. and then we walked off. I don't know what he thought about what I finally said, but that's life. But anyway, yeah, back to Recore.
Yeah, so we got into Recore, and straight away, senior producer runs through the controls. It runs really nicely, 60 FPS. I was like, oh, this is going to be great. So we had to learn these controls. It was pretty intense. But we jump into the demo.
Some of the guys who work on Metroid Prime work on this game.
Yep, this is Armature, which is, you know, why it's relevant to Nintendo. And we jump in. Bally goes to the demo station that the guy was using, so he's fine. 60 FPS, lovely. We decide to go for the PC version because, like, obviously frame rate, you know, come on. And I get to my demo station and it's just chugging. It's like it's holding 30 sometimes, but it's dipping below quite a lot. And generally, when some of the fire enemies were like shooting out their bursts, it would dip quite a bit, and it was pretty hard to deal with because that game, you need to have a good amount of control and be able to dodge out of the way of shots and keep your focus and lock on and things like that. So it was really a bit of a downer for me, unfortunately. Like, it just gave me a negative impression out of the gate, because I'd seen it performing much better, and having one of the kiosks be significantly worse than that, I think, was a bad call. I think it's fine if you're just going to demo it at 30 FPS, because we know it's still in development, it's not out yet. But showing us the golden goose and then giving me a lesser experience is a bad call, I'd say.
Yeah, and it just really... The trailers were all about platforming and unique stuff that you could do in a third-person environment. And the demo they showed us was entirely shooter-driven. There were even points where I think we went to the same part of the demo where there is a little bit of platforming. And then, you know, this rep comes around and she's like, oh, you're going the wrong way. You need to go back to that pit where you have to fight all those enemies again. Yeah. And it's like, okay, thanks, cool. So you go back to the pit. And like, I think it was good. Like, I think there were... The Metroid Prime really shone in the sense that there's a charge beam. It's just like Metroid Prime in the sense that there are three different colored enemies, just like there were three different colored space pirates in the Prime series, and you basically have to change your beam depending on which enemy you're facing.
Right.
And then you're given these robots that are sort of like your attack dogs, and you can set them on it. I was a bit confused by that. I think it's something I could get into.
It's a lot to get used to, because you're locking on at the same time as dodging out of the way, at the same time as making sure what beam to choose, at the same time as like, which robot do I have? Is it charged up yet? Is it the right color yet? Like, lots of things just kind of working at the same time. And you really did have to pay a lot of attention. I think the demo was just badly conceived of, because it only gave you one experience. And I get why they wanted to maybe do that, but at the beginning he showed us, like, look at these movement options, double jump with a dash, like these are like platforming based
Mega
like
Man.
Yeah, basically like really good movement options, and we didn't really get to use them.
It was I thought my experience, obviously mine was running smooth as butter, 60 FPS. I thought it was a great looking game. I was really into the changing your beam color, because I'm very used to Metroid Prime.
Sure, yeah.
All I had to get used to was the robots. I was perfectly happy dodging and things. So I was loving the mechanics. If I owned an Xbox, I'd pick up this game. Yeah, this is cool. I think it won Best Surprise of Gamescom, I believe.
I don't know. I think that was just nomination.
Nomination?
Yeah.
Actually, I think they won it.
Did they? I don't know.
Yeah. They tweeted later. I can look that up.
Oh, okay.
But I thought it was cool. I would just wish that they showed some of the innovative platforming stuff.
Yeah.
But overall, I liked it.
Okay, cool. So then we had our appointment at Nintendo's booth, which was with indie developer Rain Games, we were able to play the game, which we will talk about after this little break. But before we do that, we should introduce an interview that we had with the CEO of Rain Games, Peter Meldahl. So we had the chance to sit down with him, had a great conversation, and we'll play that now, and we'll be back to talk about the game afterwards. Hello everyone, welcome back to the show. We are here for our first interview, which is a very special thing. We're joined by Peter from Rain Games. Hello Peter, how are you doing?
Hello, and I've been at Gamescom a couple of days, but I'm still alive.
Yeah, we all are somehow. It's been a crazy couple of days. Bally, you're still holding on.
Just about.
Yeah.
The games keep me going.
Yeah. So Peter, you're here showing off World to the West on Wii U currently, which is very cool. I always like to see giving some preference to Nintendo platforms. For people who don't know, maybe give them a little bit of a pitch on what World to the West is, how it relates to your previous game, Teslagrad, and all of that stuff.
All right, so World to the West continues in the same world and with the story of Teslagrad. Now, Teslagrad wrapped up nicely in the sense that it had a good conclusion, but of course the characters live on and you get to see what happens to them later in this game. And we also carried on a lot of inspiration from that world. You start in by the Tower of Teslagrad playing Lumina,
mm-hmm.
The daughter of the protagonist of the previous game. Now she has a couple of siblings, but since her father overthrew the king, of course, now there's a big power vacuum, so he's a bit busy doing that stuff.
Okay.
So the children are left largely alone to figure stuff out, and they do find an ancient teleporter, just like the one in Teslagrad that leads you to the king's castle. This one, however, turns out going to go somewhere else. Somewhere Tesla must have been long ago. So they, or rather Lumina, ends up in this new continent to the west. And that is the exact link to Teslagrad. However, we wanted to show off the rest of the world because we created a lot of stuff even before Teslagrad was ever started.
So you mean like concept art and things like that as when you were developing it?
Actually, what we did was we were working on a game called Minute Mayhem even before Teslagrad.
Okay.
And so we created a coherent lore of the world and of a bunch of characters. Before Teslagrad was even started. But the way we do storytelling is that we don't really feel obliged to tell anyone. So we only show bits and snippets of the world when we feel it is appropriate.
Yeah, so one of the ways you did storytelling in Teslagrad was those plays that you came across and kind of not necessarily explicit narrative, but giving you like blinks of the past and things that had happened.
Yeah, so in Teslagrad the story was actually sort of planned out in three layers. It's what happens now, sort of what the characters do. Mm-hmm. There's a narrative of the current, and everybody sort of goes on board with that. Then there's a narrative of the past, how did everything get like this? And that is the plays and the collectible cards mm-hmm. and all the pictures and things that are explicitly sort of there to tell you. And the third layer is the fact that we put a lot of thought into all the details, like statues that aren't explained or rooms and how they got that way. And that third layer, or even like we created our own alphabet.
Oh wow.
We based it on Norwegian language to make it hard on everybody.
Okay. That's good.
And so we wrote a lot of extra little bits around the place.
Okay, cool.
So we had a lot of little clues like that, and there are clues in Teslagrad to the events of World to the West, because the Teslamasters have been there before, so there are historical references there that nobody understood when I played Teslagrad, of course.
Right, yeah.
But they are now available to be understood if you had played World to the West.
Obviously, World to the West is a very different game, but what made you want to change the formula so much? I'm talking about the camera, the gameplay, it's all completely different, but like you said, it kept the same story, same characters.
Going from 2D to 3D, basically.
Yeah.
So, something good, in our opinion, is usually the combination of something familiar and something new. So the familiar elements, if you're going to keep the characters around and the world around and keep everything going like that, then the gameplay has to really change. If not, it's very easy to make a sequel that is sort of a collection of all your second best ideas.
Okay, yeah.
So of course, from Teslagrad, we had a lot of stuff we kept out. Things that didn't make it to the cut when we had to make the game finish and stuff like that. It was like a large book and everybody wanted to make that into the sequel. And I went like, yeah, but there's a reason why these didn't make it.
Yeah.
They're all like, not quite as good as the other ideas. So I sort of got a good, very good idea of how many sequels turn out the way they do.
Yeah.
And decided not to make that game.
Yeah, I think it's very similar to like another indie developer, Image and Form. They went from SteamWorld Dig to SteamWorld Heist, which it's very cool because you keep the same world, but go in a new gameplay direction. Was it exciting for you guys to change things up and try something different from a gameplay perspective?
So it's very cool in the sense that we actually kept some of the gameplay around because Lumina was the most direct connection to Teslagrad. She also inherits all the abilities from that game.
Right.
But because of the perspective shift, you get to explore them all over again.
It changes the way you use them, right?
Yes, yeah. Exactly. So she has the magnetic lift and she has a short-range teleportation, and we had to change the lightning staff a little bit. Her father's staff is unique though. If you put something on the top of Tesla Tower in more or less a perpetual thunderstorm to charge up for something like 60 years, it'll be different.
Yeah, yeah. Was that decision to keep those abilities, the idea of sometimes like Metroid game, for example, you finish the game with all these abilities and you start the new one and all of a sudden you've lost them. Is that a way to like retain that in a sense?
Well, actually we did start Lumina off with a lot of the power you get in Tesla game right off the bat. So, but yeah, like usually, commonly in these games, like the very last ability you get is a little bit over the top. What Metroid does, you get this spin attack, which just murders everything.
Yes, the screw attack is, it's an amazing ability, but if you started with that, I think the game would...
For 20 minutes.
Yeah, exactly. So, interesting. As a kind of more top-down perspective game, it kind of calls to mind things like maybe Diablo, sort of top-down action RPGs. Do you have a leveling system in the game? Are there, you know, ability unlocks as you go along? Is there kind of any RPG-ness that's been added to the outer fray of it?
So, for this sort of game, we felt we don't want to do a numbers game, and we don't want to do that kind of stuff. What you do get is, you get health upgrades, permanent ones, and you get extra abilities as you go along. So the characters all have three abilities. They either start with get the first ability very, very soon on in the game, and then they get the second and the third ability through gameplay. But the goal was to actually give you some time to actually use all these abilities. Mm-hmm. So all the characters are fully kitted out in approximately the halfway point of the game.
Okay. How's it been working with Nintendo and getting your stuff on Wii U? I think Tesla Grad came to Wii U a bit later than it did to other platforms. What's the process like of working with those guys?
Oh, actually, of all the consoles, it was on the Wii U first.
Was it?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, wow, I didn't realize.
But we had originally, we had a PC release even before that. It's not really a console, so
right, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Discount that slightly. But the reason was we were making a PC game, there's no doubt about it.
Yeah.
But we entered a contest on good old IndieDB, which is like a huge database.
Okay.
And some madmen on Rock Paper Shotgun and apparently decided to just read through all the new entries, and they created a big article about our game just from that entry. And then we thought, oh, that's a lot of great publicity since nobody's ever heard of us before. And then right after, somebody calls from Nintendo.
That's convenient. So that's a big break then, certainly, yeah.
Yeah. So that came out of the blue. So that was definitely the first console manufacturer that we were really talking to. The relationship between us and them has been great since then. We have had we've been invited to their booth before.
Yeah.
Actually, like monetizing on console sales on digital, without a doubt, the Wii U has been the most profitable.
Yeah, I think the thing with, especially platforms like Wii U and Vita, they have very small install bases, but those people who own those systems are very dedicated and they will buy a lot of software. So you find like the attach rate is very high and people are very kind of dedicated. And also when you have like a smaller marketplace, it allows for you to stand out a bit more, and then obviously Nintendo can help promote you and things like that.
Yeah.
Have you been approached to do like Nintendo Direct stuff before? Have you worked with them with that?
We've had our trailers on Direct.
Yeah.
They've never actually been on there to speak yet.
Okay, yeah.
We would love to do that with World to the West, though.
Sure, yeah.
So let's hope we don't get too close to a lot of NX announcements.
Yeah, exactly.
And is your NX dev kit in the mail on the way?
Oh, I wish it was. No, as far as we know, it's in a strange space octopus, because we haven't got any information at all.
No.
But we would love to get World to the West on that platform. We will actually probably consider porting Tesla Grad as well.
Okay.
Tesla still has a lot of fans, and I guess a lot of Nintendo fans skip the Wii U. So if they're ever going to play it, they'll have to be on a new console.
And this kind of, all the rumors going around about NX being a portable system, do you think that would be something you'd be more interested in, or just about the same, or how would you feel about it?
Now, if we're going to take the internet rumor mill into account, then apparently it is a portable device, much reminiscent of the Wii U tablet.
Yeah.
With two detachable controllers that don't use electricity.
Yeah, I don't know. It's very strange, isn't it?
But that would give it sort of a multiplayer or two-player focus.
Right. Yeah.
Very first sort of portable device to have good two-player functionality.
Yeah.
So it's really too bad that none of our games do that. We considered a multiplayer option for a long while with World to the West, but there were a lot of hurdles there.
Mm.
And so perhaps we'll look at doing another version for that, but we would love to port at least World to the West, and in all likelihood Tesla got for it nonetheless. I mean, we were on the Vita, and this is a great as a portable game. It's not the sort of experience that you have to sit down with a big console. We try to keep the input simple. Like, even with all the upgrades on the characters, it still only uses your stick and four buttons to control.
Right, yeah.
And then, of course, you have to press select to get the map, but the button doesn't even need to be remotely available.
Mm-hmm.
It's just immediately on there somewhere. So if it's a portable system with a very simple setup, then, it will still work great.
Excellent. It's good to hear. Last thing. We see a lot of the time indie developers working together and putting different characters in each other's games. If there was another indie dev that you could work with on a collaboration, who would it be?
Well, I know the answer to that because we did that several times. So if you know Runbo, we're in there.
Yes, in Runbo, yeah.
And now, this isn't a Wii U game, but it should be a Wii U game. So we will find the guy and force him to port it. Okay. this is the Indie Karts.
Indie Kart, okay. I think I've heard of it before, yeah.
Heavily inspired by the first Mario Kart.
Yeah.
But he puts in a lot of levels and characters from different indie games. There is, for example, a Runbo Road in there.
Yeah.
So what he does is, every one of these levels, he puts in some nice little mechanics from the game. Mm. So there's a Tesla Grad level in there, where the magnetic beams sort of exist, so you can sort of float up with your cart or down on these things based on the polarity. And the Runbo, the background changes colors and part of the road disappear based on that.
That's very cool. Nice.
And then, I guess, finally, when is World to the West coming out on Wii U?
It's the first quarter of next year is what we're aiming for right now. There's still a lot of stuff to iron out, but all the stuff is there in spirit. So I think we'll manage to make that.
Excellent.
And can people follow you on Twitter?
Definitely. Rain_games, that is us on Twitter. A lot of people also follow Oli, there's Uriva.
Yes, he's your artist, right?
Yes. He is very active on Twitter.
Yeah.
And he also now, with the new Zelda game coming, is really hyped for that.
Yeah, no. We all are.
We all.
But he has sort of dug up all the old Zelda memorabilia and art made exclusively for Nintendo Magazine and by the original artists and stuff like that. So that is what he's doing on Twitter right now.
Did you manage to get into Breath of the Wild?
They promised us poor indie developers to be allowed in there at some point. But I think that will be at the end of convention.
Fantastic.
I hope you see it at least. I mean, it looks like something pretty unique, sort of a combination of what you expect from Zelda with something Elder Scrollish.
Yeah.
Although it does have a lot of stuff that the Elder Scrolls would never do, because it would be a slightly too cartoony mechanic, but it's just great for Zelda.
Yeah. That'll be a good treat for you at the end of Gamescom for sure.
Yeah.
Excellent. All right, well, thank you, Peter. Great having you on here. And back to the show. So there we go, that was our first interview. Hope you guys enjoyed it. It was a really good conversation, I thought. And we had a bit of time to hang out with Peter as well afterwards. So he was a very cool dude, and we really enjoyed our time playing the game. Bally, what were your thoughts on World to the West?
Really cool. It's a very nice art design, which is the sort of art design I love.
Yeah.
It really sort of... It feels like it's taking a lot from Zelda, definitely. We should also mention that, you know, with it, it's really cool that it's changing the formula up so much from Tesla Grad, but keeping the same characters.
Yeah.
Like, I think that was cool. I really now want to go back and play Tesla Grad, because obviously the characters are linked and there's a story going on here, and I want to just understand that story. And the other thing is, it just seems like a really long game. Like, one of the guys who worked in the game, who was standing next to me while I was playing, I sort of said, "Oh, how do I get over there?" And he's like, "Oh, you can get there in 8 hours' time." And I was like, "Okay, right." I thought this game was a bit shorter than that, but it seems to be like a fully fledged adventure, 4 different characters, lots of different game mechanics. They all have their unique abilities and traits.
Yeah, I think the art style has been translated very well from Tesla Grad. I think it's sometimes difficult to take a 2D visual perspective and move it into the third dimension. But I think, like, adding a bit of cel shading in there, using, like, very soft colors, like, I think they've done a good job of translating that look into this new environment, which is really great. I do like that you have those multiple characters, because it means that later on you're probably going to be using, like, them together to solve puzzles, like, as a group, and, like, switching between them. And I always like it when you have these abilities that kind of stack on top of one another, and you can kind of interlink with each other later on, and make kind of start out simple but then make more complicated things going forward. It definitely has a really good feel to it. I think the nice thing as well about it being on Wii U and them, you know, partnering with Nintendo and doing good stuff there, is the gamepad having the map, which is always a benefit. I think that is, like, one of the most crucial aspects. And I think, like, Tom Happ, who works on Axiom Verge, has said that his version on Wii U is going to be the best version because it has that map readily available whenever you want to look at it. And it's just, you know, it makes sense. And makes things just work more smoothly. And yeah, I agree with you on the idea of keeping the same world, but going in a different gameplay direction. I think sometimes people can get, or developers can maybe get hung up on like sequelizing to the extent of just staying in the same genre and maybe improving on it, but not necessarily doing anything groundbreakingly different. And I really respect when someone can go and take a different stab at something else and try a completely different genre, but still retain a sense of a sequel by keeping the characters in the world the same.
I also think that with a demo like that, it's good for a quick experience of the mechanics and some of the puzzles. I was doing like a really stealthy section and things like that. I think that works well, but when such a big part of the game is character, story, and, you know, sense of exploration, I think you really need the whole game,
yeah,
to come out and to sit down with it for 3 to 4 hours.
Sure.
I think that with a demo, like I said, you can do some of the more short-term mechanics and puzzles, but you do need a longer time in the game like that.
Yeah, certainly. And it was a pretty long demo, actually. Like, we had, I think they had like 6 or 7 different sections of it, and I played through one all the way through, and then like halfway through the other, you played through a bit more of the second one, and then we saw the other two characters, but they had a lot of meat on the bone there, which was really good. It shows good confidence in the game and the ability to show off a lot, so very happy with that, and we'll hopefully get that next year. They said Q1 2017, so yeah. Looking forward to another Wii U game, at the very least, you know? So we'll see how that goes. And then after that, Bally, we were feeling really very tired. So we were just like wandering about. We tried to see if we could go into another line. We checked out the Final Fantasy 15 line. I was like, surely this will be all right. No, even that late in the day, people were just lining around, literally round the corner to get to that demo. And they had loads of kiosks, so they were certainly shifting people about, but it still probably would have taken a long time.
We should maybe mention that, so over that final walk around, it was the first time we'd really walked around the whole place since day one. We were only there for 2 days,
exactly.
Since the morning of day one.
Yeah.
So stuff like the EA booth, which was just, it when you think of like, you know, ancient Rome and the Colosseum,
yeah,
it has that real vibe to it. The same with like Blizzard's booth. It, like, they both went for this cylindrical, circular area with just a circle made up of stages with about 50 to 100 seats on, like, stations on each one.
Yeah.
So you got your FIFA, your Titanfall 2, you got Battlefield, and then Blizzard, obviously, tons of Overwatch, tons of World of Warcraft. It's really overwhelming.
I'm not sure you could even call it a booth.
It's
an arena, basically.
It's an arena.
So yeah, that stuff was still impressive. But before we finish things off, we were dragged in by a couple of people to an indie game that was being shown around Square Enix's booth. We're like, oh, okay, sure, we got time. Let's play this thing. And I thought it wound up being really cool. It was called Oh My Godheads, which basically the premise is it's a 4-player multiplayer game, 2 people on a team, and you basically, the guy described it as like Rocket League with sword, or football with swords. Rocket League has now become the de facto term for football games. Football with swords, basically, where you are essentially carrying a giant like Moai head towards one of 2 goals. And in the meantime, your enemy, the people you're playing against, can use swords to cut you down and grab it from you and try and take it away. You've got like a throwing pie explosion thing you can throw at people. And it was just really chaotic, really fun, very cool local multiplayer game. It's the sort of thing I would expect to show up on Giant Bomb at some point, like playing on a UPF or something. And I've never really played one of those games because I'm never really in a situation where I can. And I just thought it was really, I just really got into it and thought it was really fun. We tried to like communicate as much as possible, but the guys we were up against were like ninjas. They were really good, so we got kind of destroyed.
Yeah, it wasn't really, I think they had just turned up at the booth at the same time.
Yeah, I think the reps were looking for 2 more people to play against them, and no one was really around, so they just approached us.
Cool. Yeah, no, I was just about to say maybe they had been there a long time because they were really, really good. Or maybe we were really bad. Yeah. But no, it was a cool game. A big problem with that those types of games is getting four people around a single system. Yeah. That's definitely where a game like that excels, and that can be difficult. But no, it was a good experience, a nice way to... It's nice playing a game without having to line up for anything. Oh, it's always a nice, refreshing thing to do at Gamescom. So, yeah.
Sweet. Well, after that, we just pretty much decided, all right, we'll just
wander around. Let's go to the press room. Yeah. Let's have a wander around and let's recover.
Yeah. So that's what we did. And that was the end of our Gamescom experience. Bally, final impressions. What did you think of Gamescom?
I knew there would be a lot of people.
Yeah.
But when you think about having a lot of people, Gamescom is like another level of a lot of people. Yeah. It's really overwhelming. Like it feels like, I want to like as someone who's been to a lot of theme parks, doing a games convention is almost a similar skill. You have to know when to queue, when not to queue, when to avoid a crowd, when to join a crowd, when to turn up early in the morning, when to go home early. There's a real skill to knowing what to do when, what, where, and how.
There are tactics to convention going for sure. And I think we've learned a lot from going here, like figuring out what the best way to approach things are. And I think we did pretty well in terms of the number of games we played and the stuff that we saw. So, you know, 2 days isn't a very long period of time, but I think we covered as much as we possibly could.
Yeah, I agree. For 2 days, and with the press passes we got, I think we did about as much as we possibly could. Yeah. We were never waiting in any line that was longer than an hour and a half, an hour 45. I think that was Sea of Thieves. That was probably our record. So pretty good. We played a good range of games. I want to do it next year. I want to go again.
We'll see, Bally. I don't know. I think next year we're going to have to maximize and go for the press day because that seems like the most logical thing to do. Yeah, it's definitely hopefully... I think Gamescom this year wasn't necessarily the biggest in terms of new games to play. There's definitely going to be better years than this, but I think we definitely had a good shot at it, and hopefully next year Nintendo's presence will be better. Because as we said, it was a bit disappointing. Like, so much of their booth was taken up by, oh, this big stage where we'll show you Zelda, but we won't let you play it. And there's all this Pokken Tournament and Splatoon and all these games that are already out. And it's like... For us, as Nintendo fans who want to cover this stuff, we've played these games. We know what they are. Either they're known quantities or they're not interesting and they're like third tier kind of things.
I mean, exactly. If you compare that to, say, Xbox with Sea of Thieves, Recore, obviously they had Gears of War 4.
Xbox booth as well with all the indies.
All those indies at Xbox, like, these are all games in the near future, and none of them are out yet, all really exciting. A lot of them very Nintendo-based, like we said, a lot of ideas, really cool things, and it just makes a company like Nintendo look like, what have you been doing the last 2 years? And obviously the answer is NX, but, you know, fine, hit it out of the park, but be more prepared for Gamescom next year, please.
Yeah, I don't know. I feel like Nintendo don't really focus on Europe that much. It was probably their weakest market, to be honest. So it makes sense that they don't necessarily go all out. But yeah, at least having a bit of a better presence would be good. Bally, let's wrap it up. What did you think was the best game you played? What was the most fun you had at Gamescom?
The best game I played... It's tied between Recore and Sea of Thieves. Okay. I really enjoyed... both of them. They're both games that just make me like frustrated. I don't know an Xbox. I want to try that. Yeah. I want to do that. Yeah. Like, really cool experiences. Most fun I had, it's got to be Batman. Yeah. I mean, come on, being Batman, not playing as Batman, being Batman. Yeah. That worked really well. It was just such a good experience. It was so much fun. VR is just. It's unbelievably fun. And I can understand that it's very frustrating for people listening, thinking,
of course it is.
I've not tried VR. I really want to try VR. And it really annoys me when people say how amazing it is, but I've just got to add my name to that list, you know? You just got to say, you got to go out and then try it.
Yeah, so my favorite game, the best game I thought was Cuphead. I think the demo was just exceptionally well done because they had a bunch of levels you could play. It was polished to a sheen. It controlled like a dream. And it's one of those games that I think is going to be a really good time when I finally get to play it. Most fun was Batman again. Being able to just toss those batarangs like a madman and grinning the whole time, like, I was just so happy at that moment. So that was really the thing that got me, like, super excited. And yeah, I guess, any surprises that you thought were cool to mention?
I think the epic scale of most of the sort of AAA booths was surprising to me. I knew that these booths had a lot of money spent on them. I knew that they were shiny and you got free stuff. We got a lot of free stuff, which was cool. But I never... You feel like an ant standing next to these things that are representing video games, and you're like, what has this industry become? Yeah. It's actually crazy, the amount of money sloshing around. And Gamescom, you really see that money sloshing around. Right. Like, when they're throwing, you know, £150 worth of headphones just off a stage just to get a crowd hyped, you know that there's a bit of money sloshing about.
Yeah, for sure.
What was your biggest surprise?
I mean, if we're talking about, like, individual games, because I went around that indie area, I want to re-echo, should I say, funnily enough, that's the name of the game, Fossil Echo, which is one that I'm going to keep my eye out for, because that was something that just came out of the blue, and I was, like, just wandering around, trying games, and I was like, this is really cool, it's definitely my thing. A lot of, like, wall jumping and good platforming and stealth elements in a really beautiful package. So that was my kind of standout, like, I didn't know about this before, now I do know about it, and now I should tell people, you should watch out for it, because it's very, very exciting. So that's it, Bally. We're going to close things out for our big, fat... This was a very long show, but I think we had to cover a lot. Yeah, hopefully. So let's wrap things up, Bally. Before we close things out, we should mention a big announcement, which we are going to be talking about more in the coming days. But we are launching a YouTube channel for the podcast. The new episodes and everything will go on there. We've got other stuff planned for it. All these Gamescom videos that we've been recording are going to go up there. So be excited. Look out for that. The channel is moving. The podcast is moving, should I say. And we will give you more information in the coming few days. Bally, where can people find you on the internet before then?
People can find me at Ballyman91, that's BallyMan91. Obviously follow the Twitter account of the podcast, that's where you're going to get all the news on the new YouTube channel. It's at TNL Podcast. Really exciting times. We have a lot of stuff planned.
We do indeed. You can find me at LordNBZ. You can obviously download the show as usual on Mondays on iTunes, Stitcher, all these functions, all these places, and give us a review. Let us know what you thought of the show. Hopefully this Gamescom show was cool and informative and fun, and a review at this time would be really helpful. So, Bally, I think that's it. Any closing thoughts before we finish the episode?
I just had a really good time at Gamescom.
Yep.
I'm really excited about the YouTube channel.
Yep.
NX announcement hopefully soon. It's good times.
Things are looking up, Bally. We'll see you guys very soon with more stuff, more video games, more Nintendo. So thanks for listening. We'll see you next time.